the country right now, or if you're somebody just hanging out in your living room, this is the Uninformed Show with Bill Burr and Joe DeRosa. Mm-hmm. We do this once a month here, part of the XM virus thing, right?
Yeah,
no, I'm trying to bookend this. Because, Joe, what we usually do is we usually just jump in and we start attacking each other. And, you know, maybe there's a guy, you know, delivering pigs to Tulsa, Oklahoma, and he's like, what the fuck is this?
I hope we still have a few trucker listeners. We really, we really pissed some of them off a couple months ago.
The Ice Road Truckers?
I was going to say a couple weeks ago. We don't do this show every couple weeks.
Episodes ago. Yeah.
Months.
We were giving props to the Ice Road Truckers as opposed to those dry land guys.
Yeah.
They got over it. Come on, man.
I think they did.
It was many prostitutes ago. They don't even remember it.
Yeah. So thank you listening, truckers out there, and anybody else that's sitting home on a Saturday night. I got to say, I feel sorry for you if you might be sitting home on your Saturday to do this. But
I don't. Hey. I'm actually psyched that they're listening to this because I actually I blew off a huge thing tonight to come in and do that. I got my high school 20-year reunion.
You should have went to that, man.
You know what, dude? I really was going to go. I was going to go, but there's a part of me that's really relieved that I didn't go because I just have this, I just feel like such a fucking loser. I just couldn't go there. Like, I don't mind hanging out like a derelict show business guy like you.
Right.
I mean, your life's a complete fucking mess, so I feel comfortable. Like, that's what I like about hanging out with you, Joe. You don't challenge me.
No.
You don't challenge me.
I agree.
To raise the bar or anything, but like, if I go to my 20-year high school reunion, I see all these kids that, you know, I went to school with now, they're responsible parents. I mean, and they're going to be like, what do you do? You know, I tell shit jokes on the radio.
They'd be knobbing your fucking nuts all night over that shit, dude.
You think so? I don't know.
Dude, I had a buddy.
I swear to God, when I run into them, because I meet them on the road, and I'm like, yeah, what do you do? Like, one of them is working on, like, the gun lobby in D.C., and I'm sitting there, like, up there screaming about dog balls on the late show Saturday night.
You know what you should have done? You should have... This is I'm going to do this at my 20 year because that's my no my next one's 15 if they do 15. I'm going to send a video a video greeting like it's the Oscars and I couldn't be there.
And you got to be wearing a silk scarf.
Yep. And I'm going to ask they project it high on the wall so it looks like I'm looking down on everybody and talking
Jesus,
down.
Jesus, what the fuck happened to you during high school? I don't know.
No, dude. I went to my 10 year last year and it was so funny. I was talking, it was nice because everybody kept being like, oh, we heard you do comedy and we saw you on this or whatever. And they were excited, which was really nice. But then some of the people, I was just like, you're way too excited about what I'm doing and not excited enough about what you're doing. I was talking to my buddy that I hadn't seen in years. And he's like, so amazing, dude. So amazing what you're doing with your life. You really did something.
Yeah, but dude, because you're like 5-10 years in. Wait till you get 20 years in
but then,
and you still haven't made it. And they got like 3 kids in a big house. And that's when it really starts to hit you. You do a premium blend at 23. Yeah, people are going to be like, wow, that's amazing.
Here's the weird part, though. The guy was really going on about everything how great my life was and how I did something with my life. And I go, well, what are you doing? And he goes, nothing, dude. I'm just in med school. And I was like, so do you realize how much better that is than what I'm doing right now? You're going to be a doctor? You're going to save people? Well, I don't know. Maybe I'll just be a fucking dermatologist.
A foot doctor.
Yeah, urologist or
something. Well, kind of sounds like he didn't want to do it, though. That's different. I'm not doing anything. I'm in med school. That kind of sounds like your mother's like, he should be a doctor.
You made it, Bill. You do a show once a month sometimes.
Joe, okay. Before we get into this show, our loyal listeners, all 19 of them, might know, you know, we usually come at each other a little harder. We're being like extra nice to each other right now because we had one of, I don't know how much you heard of that, Danny. It was one of our epic battles. It was ridiculous. We had like one of the biggest fucking arguments I've had in a long time.
Well, Billy, I described it as our first real fight. The first time we've ever had like a fight about like who we are as people and emotions and things of that nature.
Yeah, because other than that, we'll have like these epic... He made a comment one time in a bar saying Stevie Ray Vaughan was ruining the blues music. Okay? And who I know. Typical asinine fucking point of view from Joe. So we get into this two-hour-long fight that gets so heated. The girl we were with was going like, oh my God, you guys gotta stop. She was yelling like the place was on fire. And I literally looked at her at one point and go, did it ever occur to you that maybe we enjoy this? I had this psycho look on my face. Like, but it's never been about anything real.
Yeah, no, today was real. We got into a fight about, we already said this before the show started. We don't want to get too into what the fight was about and about people calling to say who was right or who was wrong. But just to give you an idea what we
fought
about.
We agreed on that? I didn't think we did.
Oh, all right. Well, because I don't want it to restart anything because it got really ugly at one point.
We'll skip the heated part. It was basically, for those who are just tuning in the first time, Joe rents my place. I live in L.A. now, so Joe rents out my place. He agreed to pay rent on a certain day. Was it the 15th of every month?
15th of every month, yes.
So lately, Joe, at one point, he's like, hey, here's a couple months' rent, blah, blah, blah. So I'm like, fine. But then last time I came to town, we're about ready to go out on a night out on the to go drinking, and he's, yes, you just hand me $500.
Yes.
Hey, here's $500 towards rent. And anybody knows, dude, when you go out in Manhattan, you could have $5 million cash in your pocket, and you're going to come home with like seven $1 bills crumpled up in each pocket. So basically,
well, if it makes you feel better, I don't think you bought me any drinks that night, so I didn't.
How do you know? I probably paid for the cabs. I paid for that fucking livery cab that we took uptown.
That what cab?
What do you call it? The livery cabs or the town cars?
That night was the night of our show.
Yeah, that was the night of the show, and I pissed through all that fucking money. So basically, the stupid argument was, Joe, I don't know, you started dictating when you were going to pay me or something.
Yes, I was saying we had checks. We had checks from from XM, our proprietors, that are sitting at the office of William Morris right now. And I said, Bill, just do me a favor. There's a check there for the amount of rent that I owe you for January. It's early, but hey, take that. Ask him to send you that check. And I said it with a tone that I shouldn't have said it with, where it sounded like I was telling you
what to do. You were dictating.
And Bill got mad, and then Bill started.
Actually, I didn't get mad. I was just breaking your balls.
But, you know, Bill started doing, you know, he started saying things that were making me feel as if I were a deadbeat. You know, you exaggerating a little bit. You go every month with the rent. You go, here's 30% here and 40%
there. Well, that was the thing, Joe. We agreed.
And I got angry that didn't happen.
You're going to pay in the 15th every month. We didn't agree that you're going to be like, hey, I just sold a lamp. Here's $30 towards the rent. And I know you're not doing it that way. But, dude, I'm going to piss away that fucking money. What it basically came down to is Joe wanted to pay me ahead of time because he doesn't have confidence in the ability that if he has the money, he's not going to spend it. And what was my shit was basically, if you give it to me early, I'm going to piss through it.
You're going
to
spend it. So both of us are afraid that we can't hold on to the money long enough to do the things we need to do with it. But the important part of this story is this was our first real fight. And I think at one point, Billy actually exclaimed to me, you want to hurt feelings? Okay, I'll hurt feelings too.
I said that? Oh, that's because you said, when you said this, you were hurting my feelings. I'm like, all right, you want to hurt feelings? Here we go. Dude, it got to such a point, you were literally outside going, because if you're going to take it there, man, I don't even want to do the fucking show. And then I get in your face going, good, then don't do the fucking show. And then we both went in and got in the fucking elevator.
I know, we walked right into that elevator.
Exactly, because neither one of us could do fucking 5 minutes by ourselves in here.
So that was a bad fight. And then you came over, last night, and I was fighting with my girl. The girl that I'm dating, and you walked right in the middle of that. So I'm like on your fighting fucking shit list this week, dude.
Where the fuck is Danny? I got to.
Billy landed at. Billy, you know, he flies in from LA every month to do the show, and he lands last night at 6 a.m. at Newark and then takes a cab to.
Yeah, you're in the middle of semi breaking up with your girlfriend on the other side of the wall. And I was trying to watch one of your awful fucking VCR tapes. I was watching Happiness. And as Philip Seymour Hoffman is doing the obscene phone call, you're on the other side of the wall. I'm trying to drown out you doing it. It's not you, it's me. Dude, the amount of cliches coming out of your mouth. Like, you know, we can see other people, but that doesn't mean we have to stop dating. I'm just sitting there like, dude, just pull the fucking ripcord.
I can't. I like this girl, and I like dating her, and I enjoy spending time with her. I'm just freaking out. I don't know if I'm ready to go into a commitment. This is what I was trying to explain to her.
Joe, do yourself a favor. Just dump her. Go solo.
But this is what I was trying to explain to her, and we'll get into this in more detail later with our guest and everything. But I don't understand why when you say to a woman, I think I'm not ready to go to the exclusive romantic level, and we need to keep this a little bit open, that immediately is equated to, you just want to fuck other girls. It's like, no.
That's what that means, Joe.
I have a fucking career. I have responsibilities for myself and for your feelings that I'm trying to look after here. There's a lot that goes along with a commitment more than I'm allowed to fuck other girls. Like, I'm honestly not trying to back that.
Wow, that's really good. I don't believe it.
No, I'm
that's
dead
really
serious,
good.
Though, dude. I swear to God I'm not bullshitting. I swear on my life this isn't a line.
Like, so you don't want to fuck other people. You just really, you want to write more jokes.
It's like
during
it's like
that time when you guys would
I'm
be
a
having
comic.
Sex.
She's starting out in comedy. It's like there's a lot going on there. You know, I might be spending more time out in L.A. now that I've signed with West Coast representation. There's a lot of shit going
dude,
on.
Just take it from me. Just dump them, Joe. You just you know.
But every guy with a girlfriend says that. Every guy goes, just go free, go solo. You gotta roll solo, man. And it's like
I'm no exception. Just, you know, you're early enough in where it's not that messy, Joe. Just dumped. Oh, hey, look at this, Joe. We got a caller here.
Already?
Calling Jesus. Right in. It said no one died. Check this shit out. You remember caller, you going to do the calls this week?
Yeah, Danny's
Ron.
On.
Ron,
oh,
Ron is on. Ron, what's up, man?
Hey, guys. I just wanted to say I'm a little disappointed. Nobody from Ron and Fez kicked the bucket after our big Halloween special.
That's right.
Anybody listen last month?
October 27th.
That stupid witch from South Carolina called in and said how I messed with the magic and now someone on Ron and Fez. Did anybody die, Danny?
Nobody died.
Did anybody call in sick?
No.
See, there you go.
No.
Like I stated, Joe, witches are full of shit.
Nobody died, but Danny's wearing that t-shirt for the fifth show.
Do I really? Is it really?
Fuck. You always wear that fucking shirt. And you got it for free. It's not even a shirt you bought somewhere.
I do have more than one shirt. It's just, I guess on every Saturday, my head subliminally picks the fucking Jägermeister.
Yeah, because it's boozing time, Danny.
You know what? Subconsciously, I think I know it's Saturday, and all I can think about is going to a bar. So I think I just wear my booze t-shirt.
How about we go to a bar tonight, sweetheart?
Well, I'm probably going to go local in my neighborhood, so unless you guys want to go to Queens.
No, we don't, Danny.
Why would you ever go to Queens? You go to Queens to get murdered.
That's where I live.
Well, move.
Yeah, move.
Take some of that producer money. Don't buy Rock Band 2 just because it came out this week.
Well, first of all,
get
Joe,
an apartment somewhere
it's
in a neighborhood.
It's Rock Band 1.
I know. I have it,
and I beat my medium career today on the drums, and now I'm going to move up to hard tomorrow, I guess.
Oh, really? Did you do that on the fake drums?
I certainly did.
Where were you last month when we had the drum battle?
Yeah.
Well, you know what? I didn't even want to address that, how Danny bitched up during the drum battle.
He did.
You were supposed to make an ass of yourself. I did.
I wasn't comfortable. The set was missing a tom. It was a single bass pedal, and I just...
So what...
Oh, fuck off. You've been playing drums for 3 months.
What are you, Phil Collins? You didn't have the right setup?
Guys, well, I like a China on both sides of the set.
I have a deal with Zildjian, and those were Sabian cymbals, so I would have lost my thing. You bitched up. Admit it. You saw us both play to the songs, and you were like, I can't play at that level.
The only thing a double bass would have let you do was suck with both
just
feet.
Just sound a little more.
I would have done.
I didn't really think that you guys were serious about having me in on it, so I never practiced the song. So then when it was time to actually get behind the set, I was like, what am I going to do?
You didn't think we were serious?
Yeah, what would make you think that we weren't serious when we told you every single conversation we had about the drum battle that it would be the three of us versus each other?
When we set up the website and you made the page for it, at what point did you think we weren't serious?
Well, I knew you were serious about your own drum battle, but not me being in on it. I mean, it's you guys' show, and, you know.
Danny, you're a fucking half-ass, and nothing's changed since the start of this show.
Anyway, I just wanted to say my favorite thing about Rock Band, though, is that I bought Billy's drum set a while ago, his old electronic set, so I have that set up in my living room, and I'm sitting there with a fucking, what pretty much equates to a plastic Fisher-Price drum set, and I just look over to my right, and there's like a, you know, there's like a $3,500 Roland TD-12, if anybody knows it out there, and I'm sitting there playing stupid Rock
That's
Band
That's what
on
I don't understand about that Rock Band thing. It's like, if you're going to go through all of that trouble, why wouldn't you just learn how to play drums or guitar for real?
The thing is, I mean, I know, look, Guitar Hero is nowhere close to actually playing a guitar, but the cool thing about the Rock Band drums is that if you could hang with that game on, like, the hard and expert levels, it really is teaching you a fuckload about playing the drums.
Dude,
I know it sounds ridiculous, but it's
Is that written on the back of the box?
Yeah, it actually says that it teaches you a fuckload, in quotes.
This is not me bragging right now. I swear to God, this is not one of my ridiculous bragging things. I feel like, as a drummer, I could beat that game on drums on expert,
dude,
easily. How hard could it be to hit the pads in coordination with...
It's hard. I'm telling you, it's. I thought the same thing. And
how does it work? Do you play it like a set? Like there's one thing, a symbol?
It's for nerds. No. it's for nerds. The whole thing, Guitar Hero, no. The whole thing, it's nerds. Straight across the board. It's the same people who play fantasy football. They're all fucking nerds. None of them getting laid. And it's just another avenue out their sexual
thoughts. You're right.
That's not true.
If you listen to the show and you play Guitar Hero, stop listening to the show and go play with your nerd device.
Exactly.
And go beat.
Yeah, Danny, beat it.
Go try to beat We're an American Band.
Look,
on Xbox.
It's a cool game, and if you want to call it a nerdy game, that's fine. But there's a bar downtown, and every Tuesday night they have Guitar Hero Tuesday, and the fucking place gets packed.
Oh, really?
It gets packed.
Oh, I'm sure it does.
Bar is called
Karaoke.
Same shit. Exactly.
That bar, it's called Nerds. It's on a...
it's actually called Piano Bar. I think it's on Ludlow if you're in the New York Avenue.
Jesus,
oh, you're on the phone, Ron? Sorry about that.
It's called the brass.
He just hung up on him.
You know what's great? He waited till his time, and then he just
shot it.
Yeah, he was doing a good third mic there.
Oh, sorry about that, Ron.
Dude, that's why this country is going down the shitter. Because you just made
George Bush hands when you said that.
I'm going to tell you what's wrong with this country. Dude, it's going down the shitter because you can be a professional. Anybody who plays video games over 30 years old, you're a fucking loser. And you can actually do that for a living. And you can be like a professional skateboarder.
I play video games. You said today you wanted to get back into video games. You said that today. Yes, you did.
I never said that, Joe. You don't even listen. Joe, I think you just have like a laugh track in your headphones. And you just think people are agreeing with you.
No, before the
show. Me and Aaron sat around. We were sitting there watching Joe play video games because he doesn't even have the decency to have fucking basic cable in his apartment. So we're sitting there watching him play like Halo or whatever the hell that game is.
Stranglehold. Xbox 360. They're playing Stranglehold right now. You said, I'd like to get back into it, but I feel like they're too advanced. I'm too out of the loop. I can't do it now. That's what you said.
No, I asked you. I just said, Joe, I haven't played in a long time. This is what I said. Joe, that controller, man, is it hard to jump back
in?
And you said, yeah, it would be difficult. So last time I played a video game, there was actually a wire coming out of the controller, and there was that one little shift stick with the orange button.
Well, we'll get you one of those, I don't know.
Joe, can you just get basic cable so I can figure out what the fuck's going
on
in the world?
We'll get you a bocce ball set.
Okay, so maybe
some lawn darts or something.
Maybe next time I could watch SportsCenter. While you're breaking up with your girlfriend, that could drown you out with some football scores.
I'm sick of SportsCenter. Aren't you guys sick of being hacky with watching SportsCenter by now? Isn't that like a hacky thing to do anymore?
You and your original velour fucking bullfighting picture you have up there.
Isn't that like a hacky guy thing? Isn't that almost being like, hey, let's go get a fucking brewski, watch SportsCenter?
Joe, I'm sorry you played sports as a kid and you sucked at them.
I did.
And ESPN brings up nothing but bad memories.
I did.
Of you getting gang raped in a shower during gym class.
What did that guy even call about that was on the phone for?
Oh, did he not even? He wanted to just. He just was saying that no one on Ron Fez.
Oh, that's what it was.
Hey, there's a guy. This guy wants to call me up for fantasy football.
All right.
Hey, Jeff, man, what's up?
Hey, what's up, Bill? What are you saying? Everybody that plays fantasy football is a nerd.
Just saying guys named Jeff from Colorado who play fantasy football are nerds.
Yeah, what's the matter? You don't know how to play?
Yeah, I know how to play. You and eight other guys, no chicks, all hang out in the living room
I got him on my fantasy team.
No, I got two girls in my league.
Oh, yeah? Are you fucking either one of them?
Fat and ugly, too.
I am fucking one of them, and they're both hot.
Oh, Jesus. Isn't that amazing
Bullshit.
How in his hypothetical world that all worked out?
Bullshit.
And what, you're also winning in the league?
No, I'm not winning, but I'm going to win.
No, you guys are, like, annoying.
I trashed it until I played it. And once I played it, you can never stop. It's fun.
There's a lot of stuff out there that sucks, but I didn't need to do it to know that it sucks.
It doesn't suck. It makes football a lot more interesting to watch. But all you care about is your stinking Patriots, right?
People that do stuff that sucks.
Yeah, that's all they care about, the team that is destroying everybody. And I want to apologize to everybody in Philadelphia right now, Saturday night, for what the Patriots are about ready to do to your horrific football team tomorrow.
That's my team you're playing against there, buddy.
Who, the Eagles?
Yep.
Yeah, well, I don't know.
At least we got a chance because McNabb's not playing.
Oh, he's from Philly, this guy?
Yeah, but he lives in Colorado because Philly stinks.
Philly does. I hate this.
And he
it
left.
Doesn't
all right,
stink.
Man, thanks
it's
for
my
calling.
Hometown, but I mean, you know, it's not an easy place to live. It's a little angry down there, even for my fucking standards. It's a little juiced up down in Philly. I think I got to move. I don't know, man.
Move from where?
I think I got to move to like the country or something. I gotta calm the fuck down, man. You know?
What are you talking about, Joe? We've been had a completely mellow show up until this point.
Because mellow, I spewed so much hatred out of my body.
That was ridiculous, Joe.
I feel like I just came.
Venom. You spewed venom the entire thing. Well, all right. Well, let's get on to the show here. What the topic we're discussing today? People listen to the show here. No, we pick one topic every show. This topic is going to be fear. Whatever, stuff that you're afraid of, stuff that you wanted to do or you never did, shit that you don't really address or whatever. We got Russ Meneve coming in today.
Yeah, he's our guest today, comedian Russ Meneve, who's really great. He's really funny,
hilarious, just an unbelievable ray of light. Yeah. Like anybody who's feeling negatives, because you know, dude, the holiday weekends is usually so brutal. People get suicidal and shit. If they really want to feel good about themselves, they can listen to yes. Russ Meneve coming up.
Yes, and all the music from the show today will be by the band Fear.
Which I've never listened to. That was the one that was, what's his face? John Belushi was totally into when he was completely coked out.
Yeah. So, let's talk about this thing that you read out. Because, I mean, this we were sort of going to do this, I guess, before the Fear thing. But, I mean, this kind of does fall into the Fear concept. You were saying you were out in Vegas and you read that article about a comedians that have to do...
Oh, I'm serious. Anytime they write an article on clean comedy, they always have to trash people who work blue, which pisses me off because if they interview a guy who doesn't work clean, he doesn't trash guys who work clean. You know what I mean?
Right.
I look at it like this: clean guys that I think are hilarious, and then there's other guys I just think suck. But I don't think it has to do with because whether or not you like cursing. There was something out there, some clean comic out there said some sort of shit like where if... he felt like, you know, if you had to throw a curse word in, then you weren't doing your job as a comedian.
Well, what bothers...
That you're cheating on some level. That's what we wanted to get to last time. Ask the listeners, like, what do you prefer? Do you prefer clean comedy versus dirty comedy? Like, it's just... Like, listeners think that if you're tossing around the F word over there, Joe, that you're cheating. Because if that's what it is, dude. I don't know.
Well, what bothers me is, look, there's two kinds of clean comics. There's cool clean comics, and those are guys that just say, hey, man, I work clean, and that's just kind of my decision, and whatever. Whatever you do is whatever you do, and that's it. And then there's the clean comic that feels like he has to degrade all the other guys that don't work clean, like he's doing something better. So that's an important distinction to make. Yeah, and those other guys that act like they're on this fucking pedestal with their cleanliness. It's like, you know what? You act like you're this master linguist or just a, you know, this controller of the fucking English language or whatever. And it's like, you know what? You fucking curse off stage. You say fuck off stage. And there are like English professors that would look at those guys and say, you know what? You're a disgrace to the English language and you're offensive because you curse in conversation. You know? So it's bullshit. Do you see what I'm saying? Like, it's hypocritical.
You know what, dude? You lost me.
Does that not make sense
to you? Halfway through that.
What I'm saying is...
Dude, my point is, if you can play your act in an elevator, what do you really say? Okay? I mean, I can be a dick, too.
I think you could have an opinion without being dirty.
What's the deal?
There it
with
is.
With lamps!
I'm not just picking on him. I'm just saying.
But that's what bothers me to a lot of clean guys. It's like you know, all these guys, they get up on stage and they think it's funny to say cunt and fuck. And it's like, you know why we have to say cunt and fuck? Because you've just picked apart every mundane subject that there is out there.
There's nothing left to observe.
There's nothing left for us to say. So I'm backed into a corner on stage and I start calling people cunt. What am I supposed to do up there? I can't. You can't.
Look, the words exist for a reason. There's cunts out there, so and they need to be told.
What I was saying before is I don't like that matter of degree argument where they go, well, it's okay to curse off stage, but if you curse on stage, it's disrespectful. And it's like, no, man, if you don't believe in using foul language, then you don't believe in using foul language. That's like a priest saying, well, I don't curse while I'm in church, but then I curse like a sailor when I'm out of church.
I like Brian Regan. I love Bill Cosby.
I also like
Pryor.
I love Regan. I love
Cosby.
So does
that mean Pryor's cheating? It's just
no,
such an it's just
of course
such a,
not.
Such a It's an asinine statement.
Well, that's the exception that all, and so Regan and Cosby are perfect example. Well, Regan mainly is a perfect example of a clean guy that doesn't point fingers at anybody. Regan's a great dude, and he doesn't point fingers at anybody. He just goes, "I just choose to do clean. That's fine. That's great," and he's hilarious.
When's the last time you actually worked wire to wire clean?
2 weeks ago, when I opened for Jeff Garland, the first two shows I did, I worked front to back clean, and it was hard. I struggled.
You didn't even say ass?
I didn't say damn it. I didn't say anything. I did it.
What was the word that you substituted in the middle of your act that made you cringe the most as you said it?
I mean, what the heck?
Poop. I said poop instead of shit.
Oh, my God, Joe.
Yeah.
I would have thrown a broken mic stand at you if I ever heard you say poop on stage.
I do that hippie joke where I go, hippies, they preach to you, but they never bathe. And I do like the hippie preaching to you. Hey, man, Bush is a fascist. Did you know that? And I'm like, really? You smell like cat shit right now, you know?
And you said cat poop?
Yeah, you smell like cat poop right now. I said poop instead of shit because I thought he wanted me to be really clean. I thought that was like
a
policy.
Why don't you be a wordsmith right now? And I want to see you turn that into a clever joke.
What do you mean?
Smell like the excrement of a feline. You guys ready for your next bag?
Have you smelled these hippie people?
Dude, I had a fucking brutal show when I was out. Did he take the stupid thing over? We got a couple callers here. Actually, you know what? It'd help if I gave out the phone number. It's 1-866-WOW-1-WOW. If you want to call in the uninformed show, we're talking about, right now, we're talking about clean comedy versus guys who work blue.
Versus dirty comedy.
Yeah, because evidently everything I read, it's harder to work clean.
But this is the point I was making about Pryor is...
And you had a tough time, Joe.
Most clean guys, when they will, in the same breath as they trash comedians for working dirty, they all say Pryor was a genius. So it's like, it's bullshit. It's somebody deciding when they want to feel like a scholar and when they don't want to feel like a scholar. That's all it fucking is. I'm being interviewed right now. These people are blowing smoke on my ass, so I want them to think that I'm a scholar.
I'm going to go out. I'm going to dumb it down here, Joe. I just think cursing is funny in general. It's just funny to me.
It's funny.
I was watching this show. They were hyping boxing, and they left all the curse words in, and every time the trainer said, fuck, I giggled because I wasn't used to hearing it. I'm like an eight-year-old.
It's hilarious. Get Shorty wouldn't be as funny of a movie if you took out the Dennis Farina saying fuck every other word. Big Lebowski.
You know what? I think the guy wrote the script, just didn't do the work. I think he was lazy. Cheating.
What about any Tarantino movie?
Yeah,
Pulp Fiction, I mean, Reservoir Dogs.
It's just, but that again though, that brings up the point of it's just the way people talk.
We're getting some good calls here. Some guy loves cursing. Hey George, what's up, man?
Burr.
Hey, how you doing?
Dude, you are the best at stand-up, man. You have a great presence on stage.
Do you feel that I curse too much?
No, I don't.
I didn't say you do. I just asked the question.
I think you should fucking curse more.
Oh, okay. All right. Well, thank you for calling. All right. Let's talk to this. I thought that guy was actually going to be on top of it. Like, I enjoy cursing because I feel blah,
yeah,
blah, blah.
Yeah, I thought so, too.
All right. Jay in Oregon. Jay, what's up, man?
All right, listen, so cursing it makes the comedy more interesting, no doubt. But there's a lot of guys who have just really good material and don't need to curse. A good example is Mitch Hedberg. Now, he would curse, but it wasn't mandatory. His jokes didn't need it. I mean, it enhanced them.
Right.
When he was on Comedy Central, he didn't curse because he couldn't. His jokes didn't lose anything.
Right.
I did a half hour for Comedy Central. I worked totally clean. And I got to admit, my jokes lost a little something. I'm gonna tell you right now, like fuck is like I don't know. That's like a spice.
I'll tell you right now.
It takes it up a notch. It's like emerald. Bam.
When I do, dude, I did Premium Blend. When I did Premium Blend, my set was 4 minutes long, and they had to beep a fuck out of it.
Dude, you know what's funny? When I have
beeps when I do a presents. There will be beeps. I'm not.
I'm not going to say every other word,
but I have jokes where they're just not as funny if you don't say fuck.
This is something that I did the HBO half hour. They showed it on HBO. They showed it unedited. And all I got was either you're really funny or you stink. That's it. But no one brought up cursing. Then they showed it on Comedy Central, who has that archaic beep from like the early, like, Danny, they have this beep. When you curse on Comedy Central, it's literally from like Candid Camera in 1972. It was like, boot. And the second they showed my special on there, I got so many damn emails of people saying, I think you're really funny, but you curse too much. So I was sitting there going like, okay, do people subscribe to HBO because they're used to cursing and it doesn't offend them? Or, you know, is it because, you know, Comedy Central kept beeping it every time I was cursing, or do I really just curse too much? I think I do
the
curse
whole idea,
too much.
The whole idea of, not to get like pseudo philosophical here, but the whole idea of curse words in general is ridiculous. They don't exist. They're not real. They're not, these words aren't, there's no such thing as an actual curse word.
Yeah, there are.
Aside from the words that are listed in the Bible, because that's what it all stems from. So damn, hell, God damn it, Jesus Christ, Lord's
name.
Yeah,
but the Bible came before cunt, Joe. The Bible came before cunt.
I looked up the history of the word cunt on the internet. Cunt was not a curse word. Cunt was a very commonly used word for female genitalia in the early 1900s. Cunt was a very commonly used word, the way vagina is used. It was just a term for vagina. When the class system started to come into play a little more, monosyllabic words were considered of a lower class, and they were encouraged not to be used. And certain words became...
Look at Joe.
I
Jesus
swear to God,
Christ, he's like a scholar on the word cunt.
Certain words became taboo only because they weren't being used at all, and cunt was one of them. It wasn't a fucking curse word. And it's just...
We really sound like idiots right now. We can't even... Let's try to get like another side. That's really interesting. I didn't even know that. Fred in Hoboken. I want to talk to this guy. He's on the other side. Hey, Fred, what's up, man? We're talking about cursing here on Uninformed.
Yeah, no, I was thinking about this, but you take comedians like Sinbad, and you got, like, you know, Bill Cosby, and, you know, people, you know, knock on him for not swearing and whatnot, but look at how successful their careers are. Like, yeah, I know Sinbad's gone now, but, like, he was in a lot of major motion pictures. Like he was in House Guest, he was in First Kid. Yeah, you can laugh or whatever, but, I mean, there's money to be made by becoming family.
Yeah, but that's not the argument, though. We're saying, do you think cursing is cheating?
No, not at all, but you think guys do it to make money, to be more family-friendly?
No, well, I mean, look, whatever your angle is what, I think this, I think you should speak from your heart while you're on stage. And if you're the kind of guy that curses in real life and that's the way he talks and that's what, like, you almost can't even count Cosby in it because Cosby comes from a different era. You couldn't do Jim Norton's act when Cosby was out and be as famous as Jim Norton is right now. So it's like it's a completely different era. But guys, there are guys out there right now that go out and trash comedians for using quote unquote foul language on stage, and then you talk to these guys in real life and it's exactly the way they talk. It's fuck this, fuck that. They say cunt, they say whatever. Now, if you want to do a clean act and not trash us, that's fine. I got no problem with you. But the second you start trashing us that you're somehow smarter.
You know what I love? It was literally one quote and now we're acting like there's this entire conspiracy.
I know it's funny. It blew up in
because I've had like four or five guys, you know, basically saying stuff like that. There's a lot. Most people are kind of for cursing. That's probably because they're listening to our show. Anybody who wasn't was.
But I mean, there's no way to talk about it. It's like if I talk about I got into a fight with a girl I'm dating and I called her a fucking bitch in the fight and the fight blew up and it got ugly because I called her that. I'm saying I'm not going to sit on stage and go, well, you know, I said in so many words, you know, but I actually have a joke where I do that, but then I say what I said, like where I go, I told the lady in so many words, I didn't care for her tone, but it came out like this, fuck off, right? But that's the joke of it. But it's like,
God, you're a lazy writer, Joe.
You got to sit there and go, I'm afraid to say this word. I mean, it's just stupid. I don't get it. I don't get that.
This is a great point here. Kenny, Las Vegas, man, what's up?
Actually, it's Kenny, but that's all right. Hey,
oh, sorry.
I got a point here. Two things. First off, I'm in the middle of a divorce, and I don't care about the history. My wife's a cunt. Anyway, number two, Billy Burr, your Philly rant is not as funny without the curse words.
I got to go with them.
Tell those people that they're fucking idiots. It's so much better than saying you people are stupid. No, you're fucking stupid. It makes it better. It makes it more.
Yeah, in that situation, I would have been screwed. You know, you could actually say that about my entire act.
Yeah, but the Philly rant was, sir, it was your shining moment. I swear to God,
that's great. I'm glad I was writing jokes for 15 years for no reason at all. I just had to tell a bunch of people they were cunts. And
the way you did it, sir, it's delivery, Billy Burr.
No, I appreciate that. I appreciate it. But I think you made a good point, though. If I wasn't cursing, I probably would. Those people really would have murdered me that night. All right, thank you. All right, well, listen, you're listening to the Uninformed Show. Bill Burr, Joe DeRosa. We got a great guest coming up, Russ Maniv, after the break. Keep it here. And we'll be back with more show. Oh, that was terrible.
Call Bill Burr and Joe DeRosa right now, 866-WOW1-WOW. That's 866-969-1969.
All right, man, what's up? We're back here on Uninformed. Bill Burr, Joe DeRosa. Just wrapping up that talking about... I think the topic of, as a comedian, can we please... There we go. Jesus Christ, how long does it take you to fade the shit out? Kid keeps it at 8 for 20 minutes. Just sort of, starts to, like the sun going down. That's how you do it. Okay, beautiful. Huh. Yeah, so I guess, you know, I guess most people like, I don't know, maybe it's our fans. I've always liked comics who work dirty. And speaking of filthy comics, no. We got Russ Maniv here.
What's up, man? What's up, guys?
Hey, what's going on, man? Russ Maniv, hilarious comedian.
Yeah, thank you.
One of the bright shining stars on the New York comedy scene.
On his
scene.
Way down.
And always a positive guy. Yeah. You know, see, this is what we want to do.
We wanted
to bring in. It's thanks. The holidays are always depressing, so we needed to bring in a guest who was going to be uplifting, to bring it to, you know, all those truckers out there delivering the turkeys, but have nobody to eat it with.
What would you do for your holiday?
Nothing.
How about you?
I just
gave food to the poor. That was fucking great that you did.
Oh, no.
That.
You know what I did? I went down to the Laugh Factory because Jamie Masada gives out food to the homeless and the struggling actors and shit. So
I'm DeRose online?
So, he's starting early. So I ended up going down there going, all right, I'm going to do a good thing. And I actually took the spoon from Alonzo Bowden, who was scooping out mashed potatoes, and I started scooping them out. And I swear to God, they were coming through the line, and I was trying to be like Mother Teresa, and it was just this overwhelming feeling of, I felt itchy. Like, I didn't want to be around them. I didn't want to touch them. And I was I was there for 10
That's
minutes.
It's a good holiday message that you're sending out.
Yeah, well, I'm just being honest, bud.
Shit, both of you.
For 10 minutes.
DeRose is laughing. He's enjoying that.
For 10 minutes, I was trying to stay in a good space. And then after 10 minutes, I was just like, look, you people made these choices in your life. You know what the fuck?
I don't really feel that way.
Huh?
I don't think that was the homeless
Dude, I swear
piece.
To God, like, I left. And I walked out, there's Greenblatt's right next door, and I sat down. I could have had a free dinner there. I didn't want to eat with those people.
That wasn't the homeless people making you feel like that. That was the good deed in and of itself,
exactly.
Making your evil fucking skin crawl. That's
no, I found a tolerance. I can walk by a homeless guy. I can give him money.
Yeah.
And then I have to break. And I always make sure I don't touch their hands. But
well,
like,
how many were there? How many were there?
Oh, dude, it was like...
Packed.
Yeah, it was like a fucking... Somebody from NSYNC was doing an acoustic set in there. It was brutal. There was a lot of them, and they
Estimate how many?
Shit, I don't know.
Did the room
100?
Stink? Did the room smell?
100? Yeah, dude. This guy's head. It was his head. His head just smelled, and he was sitting there. And I was putting on those clear plastic gloves, and I'm like, these people are filthy. We should have offered a hose down. Hose them down
like
new pajamas, and then the
like
dinner.
Rambo.
Yeah, to have like a little consideration.
Spread your cheeks. Oh God Almighty! You know what's funny? I was on the train the other day, and this homeless lady got on, and her legs were all fucked up. Like she had like some like really bad like skin disorder on her legs.
Inconsiderate, by the way. But go ahead.
And she had this huge gash. She had this huge wound on her leg. And she pulled out alcohol. She was
all about her.
Yeah, and she was going to. She was
all about
dress.
Her and her affection.
I love the way mental illness is not being factored into this. It's all about her. She's self-centered.
Yeah,
totally.
It was
no mental illness.
Dude, she's a fucking attention whore.
It was rude.
She could have done it on the platform. She had to do it in front of everybody.
She was going to tend to the wound with no tools or anything. She had nothing to work with other than her bare hands and a bottle of alcohol. And I was looking, and I'm going, I don't want to watch this. I don't want to see what's about to happen, but I can't look away. And right as she went, put her hand to the fucking wound, these two girls stepped in front of me and looked at the map and blocked the entire fucking thing. And I was like, that was God intervening with me and preventing me from having a fucking awful thing.
Memory of that selfish person getting their cut on the subway.
How did two pieces of shit find each other?
Huh?
I was curious.
It really worked out. This is great.
This really worked out.
You know what, Russ?
Group.
This is the deal. We're not as highly evolved.
Yeah.
So what we do is we bring in guests every month, and they make us more informed. on different topics.
There I
which,
am.
Which is why this is what you why you're here.
Okay, good. Let's get into it.
This is from a guy who has a 20-minute rape chunk in his act of jokes. Most people will slide a rape joke in. He goes into the rape chunk.
This is my favorite
on a benefit, by the way.
Meneve story.
Did I?
Of course, did. Those Caroline's benefits.
My favorite Russ Meneve story. I've told him this story a million times. He's doing a set at the Laugh Factory in New York, right? And your set's there 20 minutes long. He's a good 12, 13 minutes into his set. He's killing. He's killing with all very accessible, relatable jokes
hating
or whatever.
It. Hating it.
And then he does one rape joke from out of left field. It's completely harsh. It's creepy. Nobody laughs at it. He just goes, this crowd blows. All right, whatever.
They did blow.
And then he goes back to his other shit, and they started laughing again. And I was laughing so hard that a guy could turn on a crowd that quickly because they didn't go for his laugh rape joke.
I'm going to move on. I'm not happy doing it. You know?
What are you going to move on to?
I don't know.
What are you going to move on?
Now, I'm thinking about that.
What's your next move?
I don't know.
Why don't you be a relationship counselor? Because over the years,
let's get into that.
Other than being a great comic, you go to Russ for relationship advice.
Well, what's your theory on it?
My theory on what?
On relationships. What's the overall dilemma that you can't stay in it or what?
I've never been able to. This is the longest I've been in one right now.
How long's it been?
2.5.
Yeah. No cheating.
No cheating.
No cheating. Wow.
No cheating. Yeah.
How do you do that?
Yeah, just fucking rub one out.
Really?
You got to do it, man.
Okay.
It's brutal.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's brutal.
How about you, DeRosa? What's your story? You just had a nice...
This is my longest... Five months. Five months is the longest I've ever been with one girl. No, but we're not like...
He can't even like... He knows he's at war with himself right now. Half of him wants to tell the truth.
No,
it knows he's on the air.
You gotta love Russ.
No, in the very beginning, I was seeing another girl, which she knew about, and then that ended. And I've been seeing her for about 5 months, and it's for the last, you know, 3 or 4 months, it's been just me and her, and it's fucking hard, dude.
Yeah.
And I can't do it. I told her the other night, I said, I'm not ready to make this commitment. But this is what I was complaining about. I mentioned this earlier in the show, we come back to it, was anytime you say to a woman, and I said this to her last night, I'm not ready to go into a full commitment, it immediately translates to, you just want to fuck other girls.
But that's what it does translate into.
But that's not
what I was trying to tell him.
But that's not what it is.
That's what it means. For you specifically, it did mean that.
No, it didn't. I honestly, dude.
All right, let's say the sex was tremendous, like the first time you had sex.
Sex is tremendous.
It's
amazing. I swear to God. She is open-minded to do anything.
No, but you want to have sex with other women.
No, but here's the thing, dude. I have a fucking career that I'm trying to deal with.
This is such horseshit.
It's
dude.
Not,
I'm not
horseshit.
Even,
that's what I was trying to tell him.
That is like, really the main reason.
But watch how he delivers it. Like, the confidence.
Dude, I'm telling you. First of all, she's got fucking feelings and emotions and shit that I feel responsible for, too. And I'm not ready to go, I'm going to commit to you 100% and know that I'll never cheat and know that I'll never put my career first and know that you'll
what
be...
What was the first thing on that list?
Cheat.
Yeah.
Oh, dude,
there we go.
Destroying you.
There it is.
Well,
there it is. But why don't you do this, then? If the sex is so great and you do love her, do you love her? Then just
know.
Do not have sex with any other women and don't commit to her.
Yeah, but... But then that means she's my girlfriend. That means I have girlfriend responsibility.
No, it doesn't.
Well, what does it mean then?
Just you're seeing her on a limited basis.
Okay.
Yeah.
But how does that, I don't understand.
Well, let me ask you this. Was she taking too much of your time when you were with her?
We hung out a lot.
Well, just say, can't you just scale back the time rather than a complete break
off? Let's put it this way.
What I'm getting at is you want to have sex with other women. You're not admitting it.
Let's put it this way.
All right, go ahead.
We were moving towards an exclusive or monogamous relationship, okay? Yeah. And some things happened over the last couple weeks.
Dude, this sounds like you're negotiating like a contract.
No. Where I started to question whether or not she was the right person for me to be with.
Yeah.
I was ready to make the jump, and then some shit happened where I was like, I don't know if I'm ready to make the jump. And I got to figure that shit out now for myself. It doesn't mean I want to run around and fuck other women. It means I might want to go out with some other chicks and see what their vibe is.
Yeah.
It means I might want to look at where my career's at and where I'm going to be a year from now. It means I might not want to hurt her feelings and just commit to her and not be ready to commit to her.
Mm-hmm.
But it doesn't mean I want to see other people just so I can go fuck whoever I want.
It's not, just dump her.
It's not that simple. That's the point I'm making.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, I see what you're saying.
You know, so it just bothers me that it gets reduced to that every time. it's immediate. Oh, you're just a pig. You just got to go stick your dick in. It's like, no, that's not it.
Yeah.
Maybe I want to be able to go out with another woman and enjoy her fucking company and see what she's about.
Mm-hmm.
And you're making me laugh just your
because nobody's buying this shit, Joe.
No, I think he sees where I'm coming from. I think that's a valid point, honestly. Honestly.
I think that's one of the greatest excuses I've ever heard because you want to go out and fuck other people.
As I said, it's almost always you can tell right away if the girl has all the qualities that you want. I think it's almost immediate. You know?
I don't even know what qualities I want, Russ, because that's the other thing fucking me up is that I've been in with this girl for 5 months, and that's longer than I've ever been with anybody.
Mm-hmm.
And in my head, I'm going, she's obviously the one. If you've been with her for this long, you've never made it this far. And the other half of you is going, she's not the one. Like, what are you, crazy? Like, relax. You got to fucking feel this out for a while.
Yeah.
And I feel like maybe I just got to take the plunge. You know, it was like when I left my previous management. It was like I sat on my ass for a year going, should I do it? Should I? And Billy goes, just fuck it. Look, if you're going to do it, you got to do it. Mm-hmm. And it'll work itself out.
Yeah.
And it was like that with re-signing with new managers. Like, you just have to pick one and go with it and just hope for the best.
Mm-hmm.
So who gives you the best feeling, you know? And it's like I did that with both of those scenarios and it worked out. But it's like with relationships, I'm so fucking afraid to do it. And it, dude, honestly, it's not just about me. It's about her. It's like I don't want to let her down. I really don't.
Jesus Christ.
I care about her.
Levels of bullshit.
She's a great person. I really care about her. I think I honestly might love her, but I don't want to let her down, dude.
I don't want to let you down, man. I got to break up with you so I can go fuck with other people because I respect you so much.
But I'm saying, and figuring out what the fuck I want to do. If I want to go get dinner with some chick,
Russ, what's the longest
personality's like?
A year. Yeah.
You made a year.
Yeah.
When?
But I legitimately do try to not cheat. I really do.
And Me too.
But I'm just saying that the urge is always going to be there forever.
It's ridiculous.
It's crazy. And I think that the longer that you're with them, the harder it is. And that's really the toughest thing.
That's, you know something? That's what somebody could fucking call in. I want to hear a married guy who's been married for 20 years. Just like, how do you do it? How do you do it? Is it the thought of alimony, child support?
Yeah, I got a buddy.
How do you not go out? And like that urge never goes away,
yeah.
Does it? I mean, even if you meet like your soulmate, whatever the fuck that is, if that even exists, like, does that urge ever go away? Like, how do you walk down the street and you just see some girl you don't even think like, you know, I'd love to bend her over.
Dude, it's
this,
marriage. That. Marriage and monogamy goes 100% against every ounce of your chemical and biological being.
Right.
It does not agree with you in your natural sense in any way. See, here's the thing. Here's where we got fucked, okay? And especially guys, honestly. Marriage made a lot more sense when people died at 60 years old. Okay, it was a lot easier to stick with somebody in a monogamous relationship from 20 to 60 versus 20
now.
Plus,
you lived in the woods.
90,
that's not,
how many
right?
chicks are we going to meet?
Hold on. Right, so that, right? It made a lot more sense when you couldn't be openly gay and you had to hide it. When you could beat your wife and she couldn't do anything about it. And women...
Well, that's the way it is now.
In a time when women were the den mothers and men were the providers, and that was it. Now we live in a time where you can be sexually any way you want to be. Women have equal rights to men. Okay.
Joe, you're making this way too complicated. Now there's MySpace.
And it doesn't make any sense anymore.
There's MySpace, there's the internet.
Marriage.
And whatever fetish you have, you can go into a chat room and then you can meet that person at a rest area.
Marriage.
Within the tri-state area. Yeah.
Marriage was a financial and social institution that no longer applies. It just doesn't apply anymore. In a rational sense, the society we live in now.
Yeah, well, I don't really agree. I mean, that's all part of it, but the bigger issue is that you're at the mercy of nature, and that's just the way it goes. You know, I mean, DNA's running the show, and it doesn't care about you, and the sooner you accept that, the better off you are.
Yeah, you know? I agree. So, I mean, but is that the key thing that made you jump ship after a year with that girl?
I would have to say that if the sparks were still there, then I'd probably be with her, yeah.
The sparks, now you mean on a just...
Yeah, I think on a sexual level, yeah.
So, but what about on a personal level, just hanging out?
Yeah, I think it was still pretty good, yeah.
That was still okay,
yeah,
but it was just
sexually...
I think
the magic was gone, and it was sad to see.
The sexual magic was gone.
You know what I honestly think? I think the magic, once it dies, if you don't have a fucking kid legally holding you there, then it becomes like, why am I still doing this? It's like, I don't... I think that's what ends up...
Yeah, it's like Woody Allen's lines, like, you know... A relationship is like a shark. It has to keep moving or else it dies. And that's it. You know, it's the truth. If you don't keep progressing, I mean, once a relationship stays stable and it can't move, then it's just, you're like, what am I doing?
Well, I think the other thing, too, is
Woody Allen, you mean that guy who hooked up with his adopted daughter?
She wasn't adopted to him. She was only adopted to Mia Farrow.
Well, he realized that, you know.
That guy's got an insane game. That's all I'm telling you. Like, how you went from, yeah, I'll cut the crust off your peanut butter and jelly sandwich into, what have you been working out lately? You know, that peanut butter, a lot of protein.
Here's the thing, too. I think it's an options game. You know, it's like I always say to people, how can one man be faithful in this city? It's like, it'd be a hell of a lot easier for me to contemplate being faithful to some woman for the rest of my life if I was living in the town I grew up in where everybody else was married and everybody else got in their car in the morning and went into their house at night.
You think that would be easier or harder?
That'd be way fucking easier. That'd be way easier.
Dude, are you kidding me? Do you know the fantasies you'd be having about your neighbor's wives fucking 7 months into that when you're out there winding up that fucking garden hose?
I understand that, but you're going to have those...
I'm so fucked.
You're going to have those fantasies.
This is bumming me out.
You get married as a guy, you're just put out to pasture. It's it. It's over. I've heard every guy just say, that's why I've never done it, because they say the women instantly fucking change.
But Bill,
look at Aaron. Aaron's none. He got.
I got one for it. My own father said, once you have a kid, you become a distant second to the woman, you know, from that child, you know. And when you have a second kid, a distant third.
Ooh, that's a tough one.
It's a tough one.
But here's the thing temptation thing.
Fucking Porky Pig over here. He wants to cheat so bad he's stuttering. Temptation. He was thinking of the girl he wants to hook up with.
The bait. Here's the thing. If you're going to have those temptations whether you're in the suburbs or you're not. You're going to have those urges about your buddy's wife or not. But when you're in the suburbs, you don't have the fucking access. There isn't a goddamn...
Dude, what are you mind?
There isn't a goddamn Asian bathhouse
every 10
feet.
The availability is not as strong as being a stand-up comedian, for instance.
Remember what you said earlier when you said you're fighting DNA?
Yeah.
Dude, I met a guy one time. Interesting, I was going through a breakup and I was hanging out with another comic. We're sitting there boozing, doing the usual thing. And there was some other guy there. We were watching a game, whatever. So, yeah, he was, you know, a Red Sox fan too. So we started shooting the shit. And he was talking about, you know, he lives in the suburbs. Dude, how do you do it? This guy just started talking about all these swingers groups and shit that they get involved in. And this guy's banging this name. I'm not saying they're all doing it, but it's like, I really think, dude, if you take the deviant comedian who bangs something every weekend, if you put him in a cul-de-sac, he's gonna be, it's gonna happen.
Well, a certain personality makes you become a comedian that's conducive to that.
Well, I agree.
Kind of thing, I think.
I agree that you'll hunt it down and find it wherever you gotta find it.
Dude, you're giving these suburban people way too much credit. These are the guys who fucking don't know how to break up girls and they end up chopping them up into bits and taking them out on a fucking basketball.
I know.
You know what I mean?
Suburbs,
that's what's out there.
But there's guys doing it, though. I got a buddy, secrets. I have a good friend of mine, and he's got 4 kids. And I talked to him about it, and he says just the thought of the risk of losing the kids and losing her is enough to stop him. And I believe him. And I, you know, he would tell me.
And the urge is still there. So how does he
the internet jerks off, you know? But
that means my dad did that shit. Oh,
of course he did. What are you kidding me?
There's Marilyn
That's
Monroe
the thing.
Books.
I mean, but isn't that sad? Isn't that sad? Because every guy I know in a long-term relationship says that same thing. Well, how do you not cheat if the urge never goes away? Because the fear of losing her...
And love of the kids. Yeah,
the fear of losing the kid. But I mean, it's essentially, though, it's a fear-driven process. It's you're just saying, I'm so scared that I'm going to lose this person.
Yeah.
That I have to completely betray my fucking chemical
but
makeup.
That's in every aspect of your life.
You know? Yeah, but
I can't deck my boss because I'm going to lose my job.
Yeah, but it's like you don't get on stage every night because you're afraid that if you don't do it, you're going to go broke. You get on stage because you love being a comic and you love this thing that you're pursuing. Now, you have nights where you do get on for that reason. But I'm saying the primary factor is not fear of losing that thing.
Mm-hmm.
The primary force behind that is you're saying, I'm a comic.
You're talking about 1% of the population that goes for their dream. I mean, what about the rest of the people?
No.
Most guys are working jobs that they hate.
Right.
And they're miserable and they would love to leave.
But I'm saying, but that's my point. Most people don't go after things that they don't have the guts to go after something they truly love. So it's like, my point is, if you are somebody that's put yourself in a position to do something you truly love, it's like, that's true love. When you have true love of something, fear isn't the primary fucking focus. the love of it is.
Well,
the
I don't
focus.
Know if it's primary or not, but I'm saying it does exist. But I think the love could be primary. I mean, I've been in the situation.
I know so many guys in that fucking position that are married because they were afraid that the kid would get taken away. Or
oh yeah, yeah, ugh. Yeah. No, it's terrible, dude. It's terrible. I mean, Einstein. I just read his biography, and he said that even he said that marriage must have been created by the most uncreative fool on the planet. I mean, he was a pig, but...
Fucking Bob Marley.
Of course he was,
Marley,
dude. He's out there
the
inventing stuff. Can you imagine the groupies he had back then?
Yeah.
Before cable TV and
yeah,
everything?
But then he would get,
this guy
yeah,
is the reason your house is lit up.
Yeah.
That's
he would
it.
Get, yeah, but he would stumble into marriage, and then he ended up marrying his cousin. And listen to this. This is the greatest mind
well, that's
of
a
our...
big stumble.
...of our world, all right? So he marries his cousin, and then he's hitting on the cousin's daughter in the house. I mean, he was just a complete maniac. Einstein.
Wow, so, they, relative
they never brought that up in Schoolhouse Rock. well, here's a guy here. This guy on line five, Tony in New York. What's up, man? You've been married for 24 years. What's your deal?
Well, basically what you're dealing with in a situation like this, I'll tell you. I've been with the same woman since I'm 19 years old. All right, I'm 44 years old
wow.
now. And you know what? If you really... and you really got the right woman, you're gonna know it. But and don't get me wrong, because I'm an absolute savage. I love women. I see women every day that I want to get with.
It sounds like it, man. Got a lot of aggression.
The bottom line is that you're gonna make that choice. Part of it is, you know, on the outside, you've got that feeling that you know I don't want to lose what I've got with that person. It's not even. Everything you have is that person and the relationship you have with them.
Now let me ask
you. That'll keep you there.
Can you can you just define?
I have more opportunities to get laid.
It's fine getting a chance to talk.
I get to travel a lot. I do a lot of things, and I don't do anything.
Well, let me ask you: if you knew for sure it was a fact, somehow you could know that you can get away with it, and no one would know, would you do it?
I've been there, and I didn't do it.
Now,
what was the situation?
I'm in the military. I was in another country by myself.
Yeah.
With no one else to ever tell
me. Some Vietnamese girl came up on a moped. Hey, you got girlfriend Vietnam? You too old for that?
Well, if you've got a brother along, then maybe we'll talk.
All right, sir. Well, thank you for calling. Thank you for calling in and...
So he was just afraid of losing the trust and never having and keeping a perfect record, right?
I mean I don't know. How do you at 19 know you're with the one?
It's amazing.
At 19,
it's
yeah.
Amazing. I envy guys like that.
How many girls did you bang before? I think it's more like ignorance is bliss if you haven't gone out and just gotten with all these tramps.
Well, that's exactly what I was going to say. I mean, a dude like hooked up with a girl at 19 and he's been with her 20 years. I mean, I've had literally hundreds, you know, because...
Your
stepfather
your
and everything.
Up, yeah.
You know what I mean? So it's like, how could you, like, know that that's the one?
Dude, you know what that's like? That's like, heroin is one of the hardest things not to do. Once you, I mean, I have no difficulty not doing heroin every day because
yeah,
I never
exactly.
did it. I never did it. So I think if you never open that Pandora's box, you know, that would be interesting if you met somebody who's banged a couple hundred chicks, then got married and can't, and just is, and remains... faithful.
Yeah.
You know what I think it is?
I mean, I was faithful in my marriage. It didn't work out. I loved her to death. I never looked at another woman. We just fucking hated each other. And then we had to get a divorce.
Well, his backstory, Aaron is Steph's son of Joe Perry from Aerosmith.
Okay.
So
he
had that hookup, the backstage, like, hey, you know, you want to come backstage? How you doing?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
See, I always hear guys like this, and I have, like, buddies like this who, you know, they married their high school sweetheart. They've been together, you know 15 years or whatever, and it's, like, disgusting. It's like, dude, it's the only thing you've ever had.
I think part of it is no.
There's a great... Dude, I think I spoke to you about this. There's a WWF documentary, and Jake the Snake Roberts is on it.
Yeah, I own it. We just watched it 2 weeks ago.
What was so great about him was that he was so brutally honest, and he said, you know what? You go on the road doing these WWF things, and you're going to end up with one chick every night, then two chicks, then three chicks with toys, and he goes, you think you're going back to your wife after that? It ain't happening.
Yeah. Ain't no way.
So to exaggerate, no to make a point, that's exactly what we're talking about.
Exactly.
But I also think, you know, it's the one thing we're also not addressing here is that, you know, if you look at the human race as a race of animals or whatever, you know, there's different kinds of animals, and there's predators, and there's... You know, there's gatherers and all that shit. So it's like, you know, some people are just cut out for this shit. Some guys can. I have a buddy, Andrew.
She was basically saying the guy who doesn't cheat is like that lion that, you know, when there's any sort of like a battle, just rolls over and shows its genitals and its throat. Like, I'm not going to be a problem.
The guy that cheats, he's like a little squirrel or something
like that. Let's go to the mall.
But I got a buddy, Andrew, who's married to his first girlfriend ever. In his whole life, they started going out when they were 14. They're now married. They now have a kid. There is not a doubt in my mind that he has never, ever cheated on her and that she will never cheat on him. And it's just not even an option. There's never a doubt in my mind about my parents.
It's a closed circle.
It's just my parents are the kind of people where it's like they got married. You don't cheat. You just don't. And it's just, it's
great.
Just out of their fucking head.
Great.
I can't fucking do that though.
You can. Which
gets back to Joe. Why you want to break up with this girl? You want to fuck other girls, dude? Believe me, I'm gonna tell you my situation, dude. I'm fucking white knuckling it, okay? And this is what I'm doing because I know that I'm a psycho, and it's like, okay, so I'm gonna get out of this fucking thing, and then I'm just gonna be right back into this same mental state that I've been throughout. And I don't know, to listen to you, then I should just accept the fact that, you know, this is my last one, though, dude. If this one doesn't fucking work out, I swear to God, I'm gonna buy the Corvette. You know what I'm saying? Get a fucking toupee or some shit, and that's gonna be it.
It's almost impossible to give up on that thought of love and finding the right person. It's as much as you say that we're animals and all those things, it's impossible to let go of it.
I want to get married when I'm 50.
Yeah.
I think it's a perfect age to get married.
How old's your wife?
I don't know.
22. No,
I'll marry a nice, attractive fucking 50-year-old
chick.
Lean
up against her with your big bear belly at that point.
Yeah.
But I'll tell you, if I do it, it's going to be kids right away. I'm going right into it.
You got to do it like Seinfeld.
That's exactly how I'm doing it.
That's what I'm saying. I want to do what he did.
And that's the way I'm doing it. I'm not going to be like, we're going to be married and do the couple thing for 3 years. Fuck that. I'm going right in. Kids.
Bust it right in her face.
And Christmas, and there's going to be kids everywhere, and I'm going to be immersed in it. So you know.
You have to. It's the only way to do it.
Yeah. No, you want to hear great? This is a fucking thing, man. If I could just talk to some married guy who would give me some sort of positive feedback. I'm talking to this guy who's a comedian. Now he's a teacher. And he calls him up like, hey, man, I heard you're back out here in L.A., blah, blah, blah. We should get together. And I'm like, yeah, man, I heard you married, got a couple of kids. He's like, yeah, you know, I always wanted to be married, have a couple of kids. And,
oh, shit.
Wait, he goes like this. He literally goes, you know, be careful what you wish for, because I'm not saying it's bad, but there are a lot of work. You know, don't get me wrong, dude. You know, there's a lot of rewards, and he's doing that shit, and I'm literally just sitting there going like, dude, you're just like, now
your
I get
it. Your entire life is over. It's not over, but your entire life is given over to that, unless you got one of these fucking wives that'll just trail you around everywhere.
Dude, I want four
Which
kids.
I want
to have them all at once. Have quadruplets. Yeah. So then you only have to be a parent for 18 years, and then you just tell them at 16, listen, you guys better start studying harder.
I want two.
Because you're out the fucking door at 18.
It really is depressing.
Because I want to learn how to windsurf.
But imagine I just excuse myself, went to the bathroom, you just heard silence and a gunshot.
Remember that time? That was the great. That's my second favorite Meneve story, where we meet these girls one night years ago at the Cellar. It's these two fucking rags. we bring them up to my apartment in Harlem, and Russ goes in the bathroom with one, and I go in my bedroom with the other, and you know, we do our business, whatever, and then we come out, and we're all standing in the living room, and the one chick that Russ hooked up with goes, I got to go to the bathroom. Him and the other two chicks, we're going to leave and share a cab downtown together. And she goes in the bathroom. She is in there for 15 minutes, man. It was like, and we're sitting there going, what the fuck is going on? And Russ goes, what if you just heard a gunshot right now? And dude, we're just fucking crying, laughing, and her friend is standing there like,
did she hear him say that?
Yeah, he said he was standing right next to her.
I'm a creep. I'm such a creep. I think the worst things are funny. I can't help it. You know. But
because you know that's what she was doing. She was in there putting herself back together.
That girl was fucking. She was.
Rotten. I dated that other chick. That's
she was
the one
probably
that
taking a shit.
That's the one that I cheated on in Florida. That girl that I hooked up with.
Did you hear what he said? Keyword. That's the one I cheated on.
Well, but you know why? Because she did her horse shit of, we're not going out, but we can't see other people.
Yeah,
and she was doing this like weird distance thing, even though we weren't going out. And
maybe you weren't her knight in shining armor. Where'd you have sex with her again? I forgot.
Oral sex at a Kinko's.
And a Kinko's, nice.
I just edited myself for the clean comedians out there. I was going to say blew me, but I said oral sex at a Kinko's. You clean fucked comedian. Her friend
how do you
in
cheat?
The shitter at my Harlem apartment.
I made love to that
and
woman.
Then she had to go and shit out whatever you put in her.
Jesus Christ, Joe.
Joe DeRosa.
Whatever.
What a score, Joe DeRosa.
She went to the bathroom, gave herself some kind of hanger fucking
it's
abortion.
Like Hemingway over there.
After.
So eloquent.
Oh, God. There's nothing like you. There's nothing like a girl unbuttoning my pants in my bed and then you peeking through my door. Hey, DeRosa, you got a condom?
Yeah, DeRosa going, hey, I don't use
buddy.
Them. Get out.
Hey,
oh, yeah,
buddy.
You're a condom guy.
Yeah.
All right, I didn't think
I support
I thought
that.
We had that discussion a long time ago.
Yeah, there's been times I haven't used it.
Oh, yeah.
Sure.
Jesus Christ.
I'm 100% all the way condom guy. Well, yeah, all the time. Always.
I've taken my last fucking AIDS test, man. I just can't, like, that's it. I could never not.
But, yeah, that's, you're not going to get that.
You know.
Did you ever go, like, an old doctor to get an AIDS test? I'll never forget. I walk in, he's like an old guy. He goes, hey, you a fag? You shoot up? You ain't got it. Get out of here. I mean, practically said that. All doctors are the best.
Dude, that's the thing about Russ. Russ makes you feel good about getting out of a relationship, and he also makes you believe that you don't have any disease.
No.
Right. You said to me the one time, you go, Maneev, remember I got tested a couple months ago. I was freaking out. And you go, talk to Maneev. He's got the best AIDS halftime speech you've ever heard.
Oh, yeah. Halftime adjustment. Dude, this guy, Joe has never not used protection, ever.
No, that's not true.
Ever in my life.
That's
ever.
Insane.
Ever in my life.
That's weird. That's weird.
It's not weird.
It is weird. It is.
I'm
it
out
is
on
weird.
The road
that's
banging
weird.
Fucking waitresses at comedy clubs and shit like that. And it's like
I'm this girl for 5 months or whatever it was. Every time?
I one time with her, put it in for a couple minutes just to see what it felt like because I'd never done it, and then I pulled it out immediately.
Dude, that is the gayest.
She's not on the pill, Russ. I didn't want to get a fucking. That's all I need to do is get a girl pregnant.
Hey, you know
right
what?
Now.
I never heard of a
dude,
guy.
It's the gayest thing and most responsible thing.
You
want to
hear worries about
heard.
Fucking?
And you know
rent.
What? I never heard of a guy.
Pregnant.
I got another one for you. I've never heard of a guy getting a chick pregnant when he pulled out. What do you think of that?
Oh, well, I
never
have,
once,
Russ.
And I don't believe him. I don't believe him.
I have my cousin.
How do all my friends, all through high school, we were all banging chicks. No one. And all these black guys got chicks pregnant. And you know why? Because a lot of times in the black community, it's like, if you see a hot chick, it's cool to get her pregnant. They're blowing loads right now.
You know
what?
Because their dicks are so much bigger. By the time they pull it all the way out, they're still in them.
Is this the conversation that's going to get us booted finally?
But I'm just saying that
that was a complimentary. That was complimentary. out of all the stereotypes, that's a great one.
I really don't know if any guy has pulled out and gotten a chick pregnant.
My cousin got his fucking wife pregnant by pulling out.
And there was one.
But that's
girl
what
that
he says.
That's what he said. And I knew a girl that
well,
got
why
pregnant.
Why would he lie?
And
why would
I said
he just
to
say,
her,
but she's my wife.
Because he doesn't want to admit.
Yeah, that's right.
I busted
especially
it in.
Especially to you, Mr. Fucking, you wear a cape, you're so responsible. It's ridiculous.
I never go in without a vest, boy. You go into a gunfight, you put
it
on
it really
vest.
Is.
But even a girl that I knew, she's like, you know, I got pregnant. I said, well, you know, did he pull out? And later she broke down and said, yeah, he was blowing loads right in there. But
I'm terrified.
Is that the way she put it when
terrified.
She broke down? She ended up broken down. You know what? I have to be honest. He was blowing loads right in there, right and left. I was taking him to the face. It was horrible. That was great, you know, because you've really coming in. You get your button down shirt. He's making me work a little cleaner here. He's been very eloquent guest. And then
here we are.
Just came to that.
Look, the bottom line is DNA doesn't care about you. It's always going to we're programmed to want to have sex with other women, and that's it. So
well,
you got to see past it somehow.
So what is your fear then? Is your fear, do you have a fear of growing old alone?
I have a fear of being trapped in something I don't want to be in, and that's
oh,
a very
God,
major
yes.
fear. And that's probably for every guy.
God, yes.
I mean, you plan it all out, you do your best, and then you're sitting there, and, you know, whatever, the kid's saying fuck you, to your wife's a pig. And
what do you mean by that? Disrespect, or just the weight you put
yeah,
on?
Fuck you, old man. Don't come down on me because you gave up on your dreams. Like, that shit, and you're not really, things aren't going.
Oh, Jesus,
and your wife's a mess. She's a big
fat. Dude, did that ever happen, or did you just
and your
hold
son,
that line
your
up?
Son's bringing him hot tail. You just hear him. You're trying to sleep, and he's like, and you're trying to sleep, and she's farting with her curlers in her hair. You just want to blow your head off.
Why have you not written a bit about that? That's fucking great.
Oh, God. And she's hot. You know?
And you know what's funny? That's why all these guys who go out and they get married in their 20s, they never think that because they're that guy when they're getting married. They're still young. They're still in shape. Their wife still looks good.
That would be the worst.
People don't... Maybe that's just fearful thought. Like you're just you're saying lying. This is. I mean, you basically painted the worst possible case scenario.
Yeah. Well, that's a common scenario, I think. But
that's horrible.
Dude, you know what? You know what's a common scenario? Here's a common scenario. There's another guy with the last name Peterson, who's killed.
Amazing.
Yeah, like three. His first three wives died. And now his fourth one has gone missing.
It's like my joke, right?
I know, what's that joke you do about that?
I had bad luck with women. My last four pregnant girlfriends died in sailing accidents. Bad luck.
Dude, I could even see two of them died, and then you're the third girl, but why the fourth girl? Well, you got the trifecta. What have your first three wives? They all died.
Yeah.
Finished.
Really?
He's fucking guilty.
It's
what
crazy.
Are they waiting for to do with this?
I like because he looks like Tim Allen in a fat suit.
It's unbelievable.
What are they going to do? Could you do that,
dude? Cop?
Well, first of all, can I ask you a question? Is this a guy who really is a psycho? Say he did it, right? Or is this a guy who just does not know how to get out of a relationship? He just doesn't know how to bring it up. It's never a good time.
Could you?
There's always a birthday or a holiday.
That's
and you
funny.
Just one day you just stand yeah. behind her. You're ironing her shirt. The cord's there.
Right.
Could you do that?
It's
could
an
you?
Urge.
Now, obviously, I'm not talking about your innocent wife. I'm saying, but if you were in like one of those Phil Hartman situations where she was a crazy cokehead and she was like doing awful shit to you all the time and fucking all your friends, could
she
you
had
do
a pistol
it?
In no. her sock?
Could you hire a guy to do it?
No.
I couldn't either.
I couldn't do it. No. I would...
the guilt would be...
You know what I'd do? That situation, if she has a pistol, I would leave that relationship like a bitch. I would do the honey, I'm going to the store. Do you need anything? I would get in the car, clear out the bank accounts, and then I'd call her from like Fresno.
What,
and just
what,
be like, yeah, it's over.
Like
yeah.
what? How far... What are you capable of? How far could you take it?
What in a
in that scenario? What are you capable
not even
of violently?
Nothing.
I could never do.
I couldn't either. I'm not saying I could. I'm just asking if I'm like, because I mean there are guys out there that do it. So I'm trying.
No, but
to
I do think of that shit. Like, do you ever think you're capable of? Could you kill somebody like under the right circumstances?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, absolutely.
Give me a scenario.
I just wrote a screenplay. It's about a black girlfriend. I think I told you about that, right? Didn't I? Because we were talking about screenplays and stuff. But anyway, she's raped and killed in the screenplay by some skinheads, and it's a brutal killing, you know? And the guy ultimately comes back and infiltrates and goes back and seeks revenge. And I think in that situation, a woman that I loved, if she was brutally killed, I could do it, sure.
Yeah,
the only way
I
think
right,
I could man. I could kill somebody if I went to war. There was, like, uniforms, and there were teams, and everybody was doing it. I'm a real follower.
You know what fucked me up about that, though? Did you ever see The Thin Red Line where, like, they show, like, the dead Korean soldier and it's like you hear his voiceover and he's like, know that I had a family that loved me, too. Like,
oh, suck a dick. You were shooting at me two fucking minutes ago.
Well, you were shooting at him. You were shooting at him.
I know. No, that's the thing. Yeah, fuck that. Fuck that. You know? That I'd like to have a family.
No, but you would be, first of all, if in that scenario, you would be so out of your mind because you're so close to getting killed every day. Your friends are getting killed. You would go up and blow them right away.
I've always said that I would either be, initially, my urge to be the guy crying in the foxhole. And if I didn't get killed then, once I got my first kill under my belt, that would be it.
But it's just...
I would snap. But I don't know if I would get to that level.
You would. I'm telling you, you hear these stories depicted, you start to lose your mind when you're over there.
I'd be terrified. I'd be the soldier that was like screaming and freaking out where like my captain would be like, I'm gonna fucking kill you if you don't come.
For Christ's sake, get a hold of yourself.
yeah.
That crazy environment would alter you like you wouldn't believe.
Yeah, I'd be fucked. My dad, this is true
story. Joe DeRosa, you best unfuck yourself.
My dad was in Vietnam and for my mom told me when they came back they were going to his mom's house for dinner. Like the first week he was home, and a fucking helicopter flew over, and he ran and fucking hid in the bushes because he was so used to having to hide in the bushes.
I like how he didn't just jump behind the couch. He had to jump behind some shit he was used to being
behind.
No, they
were outside.
Oh.
They were walking in, and the fucking helicopter
usually helps if
came
you listen
over.
To the beginning of the story.
What kind of soldier would you be?
Would I be? Oh, dude, are you fucking kidding me? Right now, I'll tell you right now, I would not go into infantry. I would pick that Radar O'Reilly job. When I was younger, I would have bought in. When I was 18 to 21, I would have fucking Marines, frontline. But now that I'm older and I actually understand, you know, like...
That's why they don't
who
think
I am. Yeah,
guys
yeah,
your
yeah.
Age.
Go. It's like I'm gonna do what? Go fuck yourself. I'll peel potatoes for
that's
8 years.
That's why guys your age don't go.
Yeah, I would have done fucking... I would have pulled the clinger move. I would have been wearing dresses and skirts all over the fucking base.
Oh, exactly.
Trying to get... Was it clinger?
Dude, when you're 18, all they got to do is they got to show you one fucking Chuck Norris movie and you're ready to
well,
go.
Look at all those guys that signed up at the 9/11 and stuff. You know, it's like it's a great cause and I, you know, it was all well-intended. But then a lot of times you see these documentaries and they come back a year later and they want to come home and they're like, this is bullshit. And they're broken.
What do you think?
To see.
What do you think it would take for you to snap, dude? Like emotionally, what do you think it would take for you to snap?
I really think, you know, I would snap. I really think if I was divorced and I was with someone who was really vindictive and they just had all, like I'm a control freak. I don't control other people, but I hate being controlled.
Yeah.
And just having somebody who so had me under their thumb.
Baldwin.
And yeah, and then like I couldn't even talk to her. Her lawyer's coming at me and
oh,
they're
dude.
Taking half my stuff, dude. Yeah, I would definitely, there would be vandalism. I would never take it physically,
yeah.
But I would definitely, I would fuck up her car. And you know what I would do? I would figure out what her deductible was on her insurance, and I'd always be just under it, so she always had to pay for it. Or she just had to ride around with that side view mirror just hanging off her fucking car.
Dude, that would drive me nuts, that, like, yeah, that, like, Baldwin situation of, like, I can't even take it, like, in a regular argument when somebody's like, I'm done, I don't want to argue anymore, I'm walking away right now. Like, that makes me fucking crazy. So I can't even imagine if you're dealing with some fucking cunt that's got a team of fucking scumbags in suits working
for
her.
Yeah, I feel bad for him, man. All those guys.
Yeah, and it's like, they ran him through the fucking mud. It's like, yeah, you know what? He yelled at his daughter because... What the fuck else is the guy supposed to do?
But how gross is Kim Basinger to release that out there?
She's
that's
a pig.
Disgusting.
She's a complete
and that's
pig.
Perfectly in line for a father to yell. That's in line for a father to yell at his kid like that. My father was crazy. He yelled at
crazy. And the fact that he never even cursed in the middle of it, it was just like, yeah. Jesus, that's it?
Yeah, and that girl deserved it. First of all, he flies home every weekend, and he's trying to make time to call her, and she's like it's like, you know, Kim Basinger's putting that daughter up to it, and he flipped out. Of course he's going to flip out. He loves that girl.
Yeah, she's a cunt. And she fucked everybody on the set of Batman. She was sucking and fucking half of Hollywood.
Jesus, no. Joe, where do you get your information?
But y'all having said all this grim
Wikipedia.
I heard that back when Batman was out.
I just want to get this in. They're saying all this grim shit about relationships and all this future stuff. There are guys that are out there that are successful at it. And my dad even said, as miserable as he was, and he was miserable, he said that you kind of got to have kids because you will definitely regret it. And he has some friends that don't have kids, and they are miserable over it. They are genuinely miserable over it. So I think it's one of those things you got to take a chance on. If it doesn't work out, you know, it's not so bad. You become one of the 50% that didn't make it. But
why is that? Because you don't want to die alone. You don't want to have somebody standing there at the foot of your bed.
You know, I think there's something about rolling with the seasons of your life, and that just happens to be one of them. And it's just part of being a human being that you kind of need that as you get older.
Well, I mean, you can do it. You know what I think? I think men have been taken advantage of for too long. I think we're in a position right now where we're expected to both be providers and allow women to be independent. I'm sick of it. It's got to end. I want to start a fucking union for men to alleviate this codependence perpetuated by women in this society.
Right, but you need to start a lobby to change the divorce laws or something like that.
I'm tired of it. We're even. Go do your thing, you know. You know.
Well, they haven't been updated, that's for sure.
These women, Bill, they sucker us into. How much shit do they sucker us into? You know, the fucking kids and the fucking house and the cars and all that shit. I mean, it's really just, it's disgusting.
Well, it really does come down to that a lot of
truth.
I'm
sure parents are probably adopted this piece of shit.
I'm joking.
Yeah, now, Joe, how much do you think you being adopted feeds into, like, why do you think you're fucked
100%?
Up?
100%. Why do I jerk off to MILF porn all the time?
MILF porn?
Why do I have intimacy issues? Why do I have abandonment issues? Dude, I had a therapist that summed it up in the first sentence, in the first session I had with him. He goes, why do you feel that if somebody isn't exactly like you, that they don't accept you? And I was like, I don't know. It's just how I feel. And he goes, because your mom made you feel that way, because she smothered you, because she couldn't have children, and you were adopted.
He got that in one session.
Was
it Dr. Phil? Did he go to commercial afterwards?
It was incredible.
And that's what you need to do. All right, we'll be back in five minutes.
He cut right to the core, and he's like, look, you're adopted. You were abandoned by your original mother. You were brought up by somebody who couldn't have children, so she was overprotective of you. And your whole life, the only signal you've been sent by the women that you truly love, your mom and your family, whatever, is that it's all or nothing. You either, it's 100% or it's no percent. And he was like, and that has now translated into your
relationship. What is that? Either we're keeping him or we're not? Eh, fuck it.
Yeah, so basically.
Your mother.
That, and then my mom, the fact that my mom couldn't have kids, like when she got me, she smothered me as a kid. And it was...
What? I just got a horrific image of your mom with like big, you know, double D cup titties. And you just on them going, I can't breathe.
Just like mounting you. What's happening.
Yeah.
And that's the whole thing, dude. Dude, I have a fucking, my number one fetish with porn is older women. I'm obsessed with
really?
It. Really? MILF porn is turns me on beyond anything I can put into words.
Oh, that is so sad. That is just, yeah.
It's like women in their 40s and 50s that are hot.
Did you have any kind of sexual relationship with your mother?
No.
All right.
Jesus Christ,
that happens.
No, absolutely not. 100% not. And I'm not, you know... I'm not trying to oversell that, but no, God,
you ever,
no.
You ever feel like for a mother?
Do you ever feel like there was a vibe?
But no, but here's the thing. I do. Come on.
You ever feel like there was signals?
Maybe you're, so you're looking for a mother.
Well, I think what it is
then
is...
Then you can fuck?
With this guy.
God, I want to twist it into bitch,
you know.
No, but it's not that.
Hey, Joe, I'm just
thing.
Trying to lighten it up over here. I'm talking about some heavy stuff, you know?
What I'm saying is, what it is it's the fact that you get... You know, you have subconscious abandonment shit going on because your original parents, you don't know them and you don't know what they're all about and they got rid of you or whatever. And then you get adopted by parents that truly do love you and look at you as this blessing from God because they couldn't have children. And then they're overprotective.
Jesus,
and they kinda,
how fucked up are your parents that you were a blessing?
And they... And they smother you in a way.
Yeah.
So then what you start to, you know, your concept of what a relationship is this sort of all or nothing mentality. And I think essentially now what I really look for in a woman is a girl that will coddle me in a way, you know, that'll accept all my flaws and help me work through
me the
them. And why is it giving you the creeps?
Yeah, I'm allowed to have issues too, you fuck. I don't let you coddle me. It just made me want to beat you with your shoe.
It's not that different from your... It's not that different from your issues with the girls you date because you.
I'm not saying that I don't have issues. What I'm saying is I got like fucking when I just.
But
the
on
second
a,
anybody starts bringing up feelings and shit,
right,
it just makes
right.
me want to hit them with a blunt object.
No, but it's more interesting to talk about that.
On a subconscious, I 100% think that on a subconscious level, my adoption, all that shit, has completely affected my relationship with women.
But it's usually the mother. I mean, what's your issue? Is it drawn back to your mother?
No, mine was like, mine is, you don't miss what you didn't have. Uh-huh. And it was one of those deals where I just was around, you know, two great parents, but it was all sort of, everybody just kind of did their own thing. There was like, you know, when you want, like, I actually get angry when I see kids getting hugged and kissed in the storage. Like, it literally makes me mad. Like, hey, you fucking pussy. Blah, blah.
Really?
Yeah, just maybe mad. Yeah, because like, I swear to God, like, I didn't hug my mother until I was like 27.
See, that's,
when I moved
see,
out.
No, that's
no
it,
this is a funny thing. My dad told her not to hug us because he thought it would make us gay.
Oh my God! See this?
Dude, it's pre-Oprah.
That's so funny.
He didn't know, and he was raised by whatever psycho raised him, and then it's so.
Oh
it,
yeah.
So it gets to me, like, dude, I swear to God, like, I have like a boundary where I can chill and I can hang with somebody, and when it starts getting too gooey, I'm always end up being
so
like a
funny.
Dick.
Mm. Now, I'm the opposite of that, because I had to take care of my mother, because she was extremely sick, and I'm the complete opposite, because I had to go out of my way to make sure everything was okay, and she was super sick, and...
So you're the complete opposite how? You don't...
Well, it was just more an intimate relationship, where it wasn't like this distant kind of wall, where I was forced to be, you know, not obviously not sexually intimate, but like I had to do things for her, like change her catheters and shit bags and all kinds of stuff.
Jesus.
And bathe her and all that.
Christ.
So
yeah, it's rough, man.
So yeah, but I'm saying that has an impact on your life, you know. So what my feeling is that I love taking care of women and being great with them, but I feel very chained sometimes, which I felt with her.
Oh, I get it, because you couldn't fucking leave her.
I couldn't.
You
know, I had to be there for many years.
You know what? We should end
further.
The show. We all go out. We get a hooker. Right?
Here's
so
a step
crazy.
Further.
I go first.
But the mother one. That's why you go out with a girl that's like, my father was a fucking dick. You know he's going to be trouble. There's almost always trouble.
And here's a step further with the MILF thing with me. Like, I fucked older women, but I can't date older women. So I think there's some kind of goofy fucking revenge. Like, I just want to fuck them and use them and get rid of them. The way I feel like, and abandon them the way my mom abandoned
God,
me.
Why couldn't
it end
I was just
nicely.
Picturing, Joe, can you do the face you make when you fuck these mother images?
And it just couldn't end nicely with you. It couldn't be like, you know, because I really do want to have feelings for them, and I want to, you know, I'm going to fuck them and throw them off fucking out of a car on a highway. And,
I didn't say that. I don't know.
It comes down to the mother. It always does for the guy and opposite for the girl.
I don't know. Hey, we got to take a break here. All right. We got to, we're digging into our sexual psychology here. Jesus Christ. On Thanksgiving weekend, we're supposed to be here sitting here talking about stuffing or whatever. I don't know. Well, Russ, you got to go now? Is that what
you're doing? Yeah, I got to split.
Where are you performing at?
Laugh Factory.
Anything you want to hype?
45 minutes.
You got anything coming
up? No, just my website, RussManeve.com.
Russ Manive. You spell your last name?
M-E-N-E-V-E.
Russ Manive. Russ, thank you so much for coming on to Uninformed. Keep it here. We'll be back in about 5.
All right, man. All right, guys. Thanks, man.
Uninformed with Bill Burr and Joe DeRosa.
All right, we're back. We're back. Uninformed, Bill Burr, Joe DeRosa, thanks to Russ Manive. And I don't know, man, he was actually, he was a great guest. I mean, I knew he was going to be a great guest, but I mean, I thought he was really informed as Joe was just cleaning up some horrific mess.
He was wonderful. He talked exactly about the stuff we needed him to talk about and the way we needed him to talk about it.
Well, here's something that somebody is bringing up as far as like with relationships. Hey, man, what's up? You're on Uninformed, man. What were you going to say? About the one? Hello?
It's Allison. I'm a chick, dude.
Okay. What's up?
I'm 19, and my boyfriend's the one for me. I know right now that he's the man I'm going to spend the rest of my life with.
Do we screen? Is there any sort of...
It's just something when you're in love with somebody, you just know. If you really love them, you know right off that you're going to spend the rest of your life
with
them.
I mean, you just would think that there'd be some sort of, like screening process.
It's tough on the holiday weekends. You know, these guys, it's tough to get them in the first place.
So what is your point?
I just know it doesn't matter what age you are. If you're with, like, if you fall in love with somebody, you know that you're going
to
be
saying, like, this is the kind of phone call that, like, I'm trying to avoid.
I know. I tried to, you know, get people in. I asked everybody.
It doesn't make any sense to me.
You know,
what's she saying? I can't even hear her.
Could you speak up a little bit, ma'am?
Yeah, what I'm trying to say is, like, when you're in a relationship with somebody and you love them,
no matter what age you are,
you're going to spend the rest of your life with them.
You're talking
really
like I didn't try to get people in here to staff the show, and I did.
Well, I mean, I thought that we were going to get more, like, a higher quality sort of thing. I mean, I can't even hear the signal.
I was told I was getting a
it's just budget. Ridiculous. I'm going to try one more time. Ma'am, I'm sorry. I know you feel like you're yelling, but we just can't hear you.
Can you hear me better now?
There you go. Just keep speaking at that volume, please.
Okay. What I was saying is I'm 19, because you were talking about the guy that met his wife at 19, and my boyfriend, the guy that I'm...
Jesus Christ. They were on hold for like 4 minutes, and 14 minutes, and I'm literally sitting there, you know what, that was mean, and that's what Opie does. I shouldn't do that shit. That's sort of his, like, thing,
it was
right?
Mean.
To hang up on people. Sometimes I'm a mean guy.
Well, you're never going to get into a relationship like that, Bill.
Wow. Jesus Christ. Russ was honest. Just bam, bam. What are you doing?
I'm a little worried about him being alone later tonight. He looked a little sad about the stuff we were talking about.
Really?
Yeah, he kept going, guys, it's so depressing. He kept saying that. I was a little worried about him.
Yeah, I'll be fine. Look, if nobody on the Ron and Fez show died because of our last episode, there's no way Russ Manive's going out.
I hope not. He's a good man.
We'll definitely be fine.
My fucking face is all fucked up, dude.
We noticed during the break, those of you listening out there, Joe DeRosa, I know it's weird. He's the left side of his face. He's a matinee idol. He's you could be in Teen Wolf. Remember that? That's your big movie. But on the right, dude, how bad is it? I mean, it's so fucking bad. Like it went beyond the point where I was gonna bring it up. Like, you know when something's bad and you're like, yo, dude, tuck your shirt in, it's a mess. And then there's something like, wow, man, is that some sort of, does he have like leprosy of the cheekbone or something?
It's all irritated from shaving. Honestly, it's that bad where you were like, shit, I don't want to say anything. Are you fucking with me?
Wouldn't you use a fucking butter knife?
I know Aaron finally said something during the break, like,
I don't know, it just gets, this side of my face breaks out.
Stop touching it.
I can't.
You're gonna make it worse.
Joe, does it look horrible, Danny, or does it just look like I'm a little broken out on that side?
It's noticeable. It's definitely noticeable.
Dude, it looks like he was on the outer spray of like a shotgun blast, like a pellet. Pellet, dude, not like a...
But is it noticeable,
BBs.
Like where you'd be like, ugh, he's got some...
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's bad.
Stop
dude.
It. It's not no that bad.
Yeah.
It's that bad where you go, ugh, what happened to his face?
Dude, is the pal talk up?
Yeah, well, let me try and zoom. I can try and zoom in on that side of his face.
Okay.
All right, let me try that.
No, let's. How about we don't do this?
Why don't we? Come on, Joe. We you know, we haven't really been taking that many calls. Let's see if we can get in, zoom in on the side of Joe's face. Wow, look at that technology. Is Joe a little bit lower? All right, Joe, look a little more to your right. Okay, there we go.
Focus,
okay, now we got to focus. Jesus, that really looks like one of those before pictures. My God, Joe.
I can't see it. Hold on.
You can't see that?
It's not.
I don't have my glasses on. Hold on.
Oh, that's even adding to it. Look at him squinting.
How bad's it look over there?
It looks better with the glasses.
Yeah, you look like a smart guy who doesn't know how to shave. As opposed to before, you look like a dropout.
Yeah, look, it's all fucking here.
You're a mess.
Jesus.
Joe, do you go against the grain? You got to go with it. You got to go with the grain. You have to change your blade.
I do both. I do against and with.
You got to take one of those badger haired brushes like the 1800s.
Are you kidding?
And you got to get the scruff, up. No, you know what it is? I went and I got a straight razor shave about a year ago. It was one of my things to do, my Oprah things to do list. I'm going to ride in a hot air balloon. I'm going to get a straight razor shave. You know, the just gay shit that you want to do. So I was like, I always want to get a straight razor shave. It always looked relaxing to me. You know, they put that hot towel on your face. Dude, it was one of the most painful fucking things I've ever... You been there, Danny?
Yeah, I tried it once. The guy, like, I was about to get up out of the chair, and, like, it was, like, a fleeting, you know, comment. The guy's like, oh, you want to shave? And I was like, eh, fuck it.
Yeah. And this is like a manly Frank Sinatra kind of thing to do. Yeah. Let me get a straight razor shave like I'm an outlaw.
Fucking hurt. So, well, first of all, I knew that, so, like, you know, this was a bad idea when I saw the amount of blood that was coming off of my face. Like, he kept, like, dabbing me, and I knew just it was not a
bleeder,
good thing.
Huh?
Oh, yeah, heavy. It was bad.
So were your face all scabbed up after?
No, it wasn't scabbed up. It's just like it's a completely different kind of shave. Like I'm sure if I went back, like, you know, every week or whatever, get a straight razor shave, it wouldn't be like that every time.
Dude, it's so
close. It was my first time.
I didn't have to shave for like, and it was noticeably didn't have to shave for like 4 days. 4 days. And the whole process took like a half hour, and he's going just against the grain. You just keep hearing. I just kept expecting that.
You just said you're supposed to shave with the grain.
I don't know what this guy was doing, dude. He was going like, I don't know, understand. Dude, it just seemed like he was going at weird angles. Let's say that. But in that thing, dude, when I came up, dude, I looked like I had gotten into a slap fight with a fucking gorilla. And I had a show that night. I was doing the whole Vegas thing. You know when you go to Vegas, you get that little rat pack. Hey, I'm going to fucking, right? So I go to get this straight razor face. Dude, I swear to God, I had these like three huge red blotches. Like, and then on my neck and everything, and the guy was literally going like, nah, you did all right. There usually guys with his skin as fair as yours, and he basically taught me how to shave. He goes, you got to change the blade. You go lightly with the grain.
When you say you got to change the blade, I know you got to change the blade, but how often? I mean,
here's something that you should do, dude. Let your beard go for like 3-4 days, and then figure out which way it goes on your face. Because I noticed on my neck. Like right here, like I shave up, but here it goes down. So I have to like switch which direction. And ever since I've been doing that, Joe, I've been the good looking son of a bitch that you see across from me right now.
I'm really upset about this right now. I'm very self-conscious about it. And,
you look like you shaved with a broken vase.
Thank you.
Joe, you know, it's the interventions on this show are always harsh. You know that, but you know that they're coming.
No, but
they're
it's
coming,
bad
they're
enough
coming
that, like,
from a
I
place
don't
of
even want to like go out tonight. Like, I'm
no,
embarrassed.
Dude, little aqua velva. You slap it
I
on.
I put fucking 10 skin on it, and it didn't do anything.
Dude, you know what you need? You just need a butterfly bandage right over your other eye. You look like you got into a fight.
Then yeah, what does it look like? Does it look like acne, or does it just look like I got marked up by something?
No, it looks like it looks like you're breaking out.
Right?
Yeah.
But it looks fucking bad. It looks like a lot of breaking out. It looks like acne.
Well, don't worry about it. I mean, if you're going to be at a bar later, it's going to be a nice dimly lit place. I wouldn't worry about it too much.
Yeah, but those things cast shadows.
Yeah.
That's bad.
Joe, what do you
I don't like how Aaron comes on and chimes in now and again.
I actually invited him to chime in.
Yeah.
Because I didn't know if Danny was going to be in here, and we just, you know, I couldn't just sit across from me by myself, all by my
Danny
lonesome.
Danny, are you supposed to be fetching us a pizza or something?
It's here already.
Dude, I fucking seriously, Danny. How is it like when you saw
Joe,
me?
Joe,
you like,
your
oh,
face,
what's on his face
is fucked up. Yeah, you need to learn how to shave.
It's not like I'm going to be like, ooh, who's that? It's just like, oh, Joe's breaking out. That's not
You're not
going
to be like, what?
Huh?
You're not going to be like, what?
What? Did you I say just, something stupid? What?
Yeah, ooh.
But is it bad where, like, if I was talking to a chick, she's going to be like, oof.
I don't know. Maybe I'm not a chick. I couldn't tell you.
What do you think? Don't be a dick just to get away.
No, probably. No, probably. It looks pretty fucked
up. You know what you have to do? You got to be real dramatic tonight,
Joe. It looks like it's really broken out. It looks like it's probably starting to hurt.
You look like the ass cheek of most of the truckers who listen to us.
And it's because you keep touching it, so it's making it redder.
So how do you get it to go away? What do you do?
Stop touching it. Don't put any new skin on it. Don't keep touching it.
You just ate pizza, Joe. Stop touching your face.
Don't stress about it. Just relax.
What do?
You just relax. It's like it looks like it's shaving bumps. It looks.
You want an ice pack for the last hour of this show, Joe?
It looks like you used a really old ass razor.
Something is fucked up though, because when it's only happening on this side of my face, and that's the side I sleep on. Something's going on with when I'm sleeping, like where my pores on the side of my face are getting clogged up and shit.
Maybe you have bed bugs.
Yeah,
bugs.
Yeah, and they're biting your face.
Does your girlfriend bring some germy stuffed animal from her childhood into the bed?
Oh, my God. Do you think I could have bed bugs?
Could be.
Oh, yeah. You know what? That's right. I never even thought about that.
I had an itchy thing on my arm. I didn't know what it was.
Joe, you have bed bugs. What is it, the fucking 1800s?
Where the fuck could I have...
filthy-ass apartment you live in.
Oh, please. It's fucking spotless in there. Where could I have gotten bed bugs from? I was at a really dirty hotel for Jay's wedding. Do you think I brought bed bugs back?
Dude, you got the measles. There you go. Look at that picture on the internet, Joe. Does that look familiar?
It kind of looks like your face a little bit. Look at that guy's back.
We're looking at this guy.
Yeah, but this doesn't itch or anything. It doesn't hurt.
You don't see the guy in the photo itching, do you? He's got his hands very relaxed on his hips.
Would it hurt, though? Do bed bugs itch?
I don't know. I live in a clean apartment.
They itch. They itch. They itch. They itch.
It's on the other side, too.
It's a little bit.
It's over here.
Yeah, it's razor irritation. That's what it is.
Probably, but I'm saying the side of your face is more sensitive.
It gets so bad right here.
Why don't you get that shit that black guys use?
I got it. Ten skin. I have that shit.
And you just how does that stuff work? You
have
just
you tried
put it on your
changing
face?
Razors, like different brands, going from Quattro to a Gillette or something.
Do they make a six blade? Maybe you got too many blades, Joe. Why don't you go back to the chick one that they shaved their legs with? The single blade, a little pink one for you.
I got to go to fucking jury duty on Monday with this shit on my face now. God damn it.
Dude, you want to get out of jury duty.
Yeah.
Why don't you just sit there and look like a fucking scraped up psycho and they won't pick you?
How can you get out of jury duty? What's like a good way to get out of it?
Whatever. Well, first of all, you're going to be sitting there the entire day, no matter what, I think. But what the fuck happened? I got picked for one. And all you have to do is whatever the crime is. You know, this guy got rear-ended by a tow truck, and then you just walk up to the judge. I got issues with tow trucks. You know, I hate tow trucks, and I'm racially biased against tow trucks, and then they'll let you go. But they'll stick you back in the gene pool, and then you got to sit there again.
What I was going to say is, look, I work nights, and I'm not going to lie to you. I'm going to be very drowsy and nodding off throughout the day, so I'm not going to be the most alert guy because I have to work nights till 2 a.m., and I'm not going to not do that, so...
I don't know. If there's anybody out there who can come up with better excuses on how to get out of jail. If anybody out there has gotten out of jury duty, Joe.
Is that what you did? You just said I got issues with
No, I
trucks?
Didn't. I did my duty. I was actually excited to do it. I went on a fucking, this guy was getting busted for breaking and entering. And you know what? I didn't have the heart. That's what I realized, to send him to jail. And unfortunately, I was an alternate. And I was just sitting there and I got to watch the whole trial. And then when it came time to make the decision, none of the jurors had been challenged. So as an alternate, I got to go home. And that's an excuse you could use. You could just say, look, man, I just don't have it in me. Don't say a pedophile case because that'll take 6 months out of your life. Just say, I just don't have it in me to send. I just don't feel that I could send somebody to jail. If anybody has a better way, we got to get Joe out of jury duty, okay? Because we don't want to miss another one of these great shows that we're doing here. Call 1-866-WOW-1-WOW if you know how to. Look at the phones lighting up. Look at our degenerate listeners.
Joe, just tell them that you have bed bugs and you have to be home for the fumigator.
Yeah, tell them whatever's on the side of your face is a rash.
Contagious.
It's contagious, yeah. I have a contagious ass rash on the side of my face. when I was signing.
I'm really
I was autographing a gay trucker's.
You know what it's from, Joe? It's from that one time you didn't use a condom.
Yeah.
I know.
I knew this would happen.
Jesus Christ. What a Cub Scout, Joe. There's no way you're not going to heaven.
What if I have bed bugs, man?
Well, you got to burn the mattress, and you got to stick your face in some sort of chloride. Something with iodine in the end. Peroxide,
wouldn't
chloride.
Wouldn't I know if I had bed bugs, for Christ's sakes?
No, they're really small. No, like, you know what?
Wouldn't I be bitten all over my body?
Well, they start with the face. A lot of people don't know that.
Fuck off.
They do. All right, let's try to get Joe out of jury duty. What do we got here? Let's talk. Argued with a defense attorney. I don't want to hear that. Let me hear line two.
Hey, Bill.
Hey, man. What's up? You gonna get Joe out of jury duty or what?
Yeah, you just argue with a defense attorney, man. It'll get you out every time. I had one when I was on jury duty in Atlanta. And the guy, you know, they ask you some of their questions and stuff. And the defense attorney was like a real famous Johnny Cochran wannabe.
Oh, you're saying in the beginning when they can challenge jurors, when they come up and they ask you questions like, what do you do for a living? And what do you say? Whoa, what's it to you?
At the time, I worked in news radio at the time, so I told him, I said, well, I know what kind of piece of crap you are, and I don't like you personally. And boom, that got me right off real quick.
Oh, there you go. That's perfect.
Just tell him that. I don't like you personally. You're a piece of crap, and you look like the guy that screwed my sister. Fuck you.
Dude, you can't get all the way to that level.
No, you can't do that. But I mean,
well, we're trying to help Joe out here, sir. We'd appreciate it if you actually give us some information you can
use. What do they pay you every day? What do they pay you?
What, $12?
Yeah, but after you say, I don't like that guy, they send you back to the juror room, and then they wait to see if you get selected again, correct? You're telling you...
Yeah, but by the time you do that, well, I don't know. Shoot. Atlanta, Fulton County jury duty, it's packed. So by the time you're sitting in there all day long, dude, it's the end of the day and you're going home.
All right, so there's one option.
Is that the only thing? You just have to get through the whole day without getting put into
that's
a jury?
That's what you got
to
do.
All you have
I thought it was like you show up and they go, here's the case, this is it.
No.
Okay, so you just got to get, it's a game. You just got to get through the whole day without getting picked.
Exactly. Here's a guy, Matt in Arizona. How'd you get out of jury duty?
Hey guys, I got picked, and I just really went towards, you know, pro state, pro cop, and really said, yeah, you know what, cop says it, and they raise you go through all the questions, but they ask the question of, do you feel that, you know, the police or whatever evidence is in front of you, you know, could be biased or whatever it is, and I just raised my hand and said, no, you know, I think it's if the police say it, it's got to happen, and the guy who was sitting there probably was getting a little uneasy because they didn't want to pick me, so.
And then what? Then they send you back into that room, and then you got out.
Yeah, well, they asked if anybody thinks that, you know, any evidence that they brought forth, and it was a DUI case, so I raised my hand, they said, well, what do you think? Well, if you blew the limit or you blew over the limit, you know, it's kind of a scientific thing. There's no interpretation of that, and, you know, my name was kind of called off pretty quick.
Now, let me ask you this. Do you believe any of that, or are you just trying to get out of it?
Oh, getting out of it, dude. What, do you want to spend 2 days with a bunch of other, like, housewives that just want to sit there and do nothing? Bullshit. You sit in a jury room, really, with, you know, your peers, which aren't your peers. It's just a bunch of fucking whack.
Dude, this is so...
Work.
All right, well, thanks for calling, Matt. This is so easy. Look at this. Tony in Ohio, line number five. Tony, how'd you get out of jury duty?
Hey, it's real easy, guys. When they take you in there, they're going to sit you down. They're going to have you fill out a questionnaire. They're asking you a bunch of bullshit questions. You don't have to say anything racist or say I'm pro-cop. You just keep saying, I don't want to be here. I refuse to be here. I don't want to be here. And they'll call you a hostile juror, and they'll throw you the hell right out of there.
All right, well, let me ask you this. Let me ask you this. How long did you have to just keep saying that over and over again? Like, I want to go fast. I want to go fast. I want to go fast.
I was there for like 2 hours. They had me fill out the questionnaire, and every question on the written questionnaire, I just wrote, don't want to be here. Don't want to be here. So they looked at the guy. I go, no, I want to be here. I got a real job. You know, your $20 a day ain't going to cover what I'm missing. He goes, well, you realize this is your, you know, duty, blah, blah, blah. I just kept saying, look, I don't want
to
be here.
Oh, so they tried to do the scared straight. The guy with the white shirt comes out.
And then they started asking you questions. Well, how do you feel? I don't want to be here. Well, how do you feel? I don't want to be here. I don't want to. So finally, they let me go. About 6 months later, they called my wife, and she's like, man, I don't... I go, just do the same shit I did. She went in there, did the same thing. She was out by lunch.
All right, man. Well, thanks for calling. Jesus Christ, Joe. So you can be honest. I don't want to be here.
All right, fuck
it's a great show. What we're doing right here, we're teaching people how, you know.
I don't want to. I don't have the balls fair to trial. Do that one. That's ballsy. I don't think I have the balls to do that.
So
one.
So what are you going
to
come up with? Do you want to just walk in there and go, my face, my face, look at my face, dude? Keep shaving. However you're shaving, up until jury duty, dude. There's no way you had a limp to that fucking shit on the side of your face. I mean, that's it.
Dude, I'm freaked out. I got some kind of itchy shit on my arm, and I got fucking shit on my face. I got fucking... You what do. If I got bed bugs, man?
You have an eczema. That's a great word to get you going. You got an eczema, Joe.
But you don't have an eczema. You have eczema.
Oh, eczema.
There that's like go. Saying you have an AIDS.
You got the dirty AIDS.
You just got it or you don't. fuck. What are you going to do?
By the way, you were slowly sort of on the mic again.
No, I wasn't. I moved the mic away.
You didn't, Joe. Didn't you see me go like that? And then I just started laughing.
I went like that with the mic, like that.
Joe, I'm telling you. Joe, for our frequent listeners, they know Joe has a habit of eating on the microphone. Sorry, man. I'm just letting you know.
I wasn't eating.
you were after eating.
This sucks, dude. I hate that my face is fucked up. People with fucked up faces, it freaks me out a little bit, and I'm all upset about it right now. I'm sorry. Any other? Well, I get
it. Says he hates women and should be raped.
No, I
what
get
is,
it.
What is
I
this?
Get how to get out of jury duty, and I'm afraid that somebody's going to hear this and know what I'm up to, and I'm going to get
this
arrested.
Guy, he got called 4 times, never went, nothing happened. That's the thing, is it? And like, I can't imagine these people. Like, when you get put on like the OJ trial, and it's just like, what kind of a life do you have? Like, how long was that trial? That was like 8 months, 9 months. The whole jury selection process and all that crap. All I remember was he got arrested in summer of 94, and they didn't come back until October 05, October 95 when I first moved down here. So it was like a little over a fucking year of your life, and you got to sit there.
Well, exhibit 2,607.
What do they pay
notice,
every day? $40?
If you notice the grass.
Huh?
What do they pay every day? $40?
I don't remember, dude. It's so insignificant, and it's such a slap in the face, and they just sit there going like, this is your civic duty. This is what they use, as they always do. They wave the American flag to get your patriotic juices going, and then they just fuck you in the ass financially.
America's never done anything for me. That's what, no, I'll go and do that fucking speech from Malcolm X. Plymouth Rock landed on us. I'll just do that fucking speech when they tell me it's my civic
duty. When do you have jury duty? When is it up?
Monday. I got a call Sunday night, and I got to go in on Monday.
What, they called you up?
They didn't even call me. They sent me the fucking summons for it.
Oh, okay.
So I got to call the number Sunday night, and then it tells me where to report. I got to report to the Supreme Court of something.
Oh, Joe.
Part of me felt like I should just do it because I don't make any money during the day anyway.
Well, that's the thing. If you don't have any road gigs, you can technically do it. You can definitely do like a pass if you get some road gigs. Joe, just do what these fucking people said. What these people say. You just...
I'm in town until... Yeah, I'm in town the whole time because I'm at Gotham this coming weekend, and then the weekend after that is your weekend
this
in Carolina.
This is what you
so
do,
I'm
Joe.
I'm in town.
You just keep whispering. Barely audible. I have a disease. I have a disease. And they go, what? Just keep... I have a disease. And you just rock it. I have a disease. I have a disease. That's it. It's over.
All right.
Just the fact that you would have the balls to sit there and do it. I have a disease. Build borders around the country. I have a disease. Just say
what if every time
subtly, just say, is there a way to be racist but not pick a group? Can you just be like, you're just homogeneously racist?
They what if every work. Time they ask me a
they
question?
They don't
want to
work. You just keep saying they don't want to work.
Every time they ask me,
what's the most homogeneously, just straight across the board, you could apply it to anybody, racist thing you can come up with?
They don't want to work was pretty good.
You don't want to work?
They don't want to work.
You see?
They don't want to work. That's what you get when you let them
no, that's
into
a,
the country.
That's what you get. That's a good one.
That's what you get.
Dude, I'm fucking telling you. It's what I said.
Yeah.
It's what I said. It's always some guy walking to some rusted out hunk of shit. Hands always like, you know, at a 45 sort of bent degree angle.
Yeah, I go,
it's
what
I said, dude.
Me?
Dude, it's what I said.
That's what you get.
That's what you get, man.
You know what I mean. That's what you get.
Fucking, you know, you try to help people.
I'm fucked. I'm going to be in this thing for 3 months. I'm going to get stuck on the one Myrtle trial going on in New York City this month or whatever. And I'm going to be fucked, Bill.
I hope you do, Joe. I really hope you get one of those five-year-long cases, and they keep you in a Red Roof Inn, sequestered. One of those sequestered jurors. Dude, yeah. That's what you got to realize, Joe. In the end of it, you get to write a book. So all you do is you just text message yourself during the trial. You just make notes.
Just hang out with the other jurors, try to bang as many of them as you can.
You can't. That's a great way to get kicked off a jury.
What?
You just fucking start hitting on everybody.
Well, that's in the jury. Is there any reason you shouldn't be on this juror? Yes, because I fucked jurors 35,
yeah.
37.
Well, no, right in the beginning, from the get-go. Why? Because I see juror number 17. Is she looking hot?
You look like you got a nice cock on you there, Mr. Defense Attorney.
Jesus.
What do you say there, boy? Yeah?
You going that route?
I'll go any route.
Speaking of that shit, would you be capable of that, Joe?
I couldn't fuck a guy. I think I could fuck a tranny, though. I don't know
you
if I could.
You could fuck a tranny? Let me ask you this, though.
I could get a blowjob from a tranny. I don't know if I could fuck one, though.
What's at stake, though? We were talking about earlier, but before we try to get you out of jury duty, like what you were capable of.
Yes.
Like, could you kill somebody? So now you're saying, I could tell you right now.
No, I couldn't.
I couldn't have sex with a tranny. I couldn't.
I don't think I could have sex with a tranny, but I think I could get a blowjob from one. Yes, if she was hot, but you gotta be a hot tranny.
You didn't even bring the hacky desert island scenario.
All right, I'm on a desert island.
No.
There's no way I'm getting rescued. It looks like a chick. You didn't do anything. You're just like, I can get.
Yeah, by desert island, I mean a bathroom in New York City. Any bathroom that I am stranded in.
You mean funny? You serious? You could actually do that?
I think I could. Yeah.
And you could just walk away.
I masturbated
and just,
to it, so I mean, I'm assuming I could.
To what?
To trannies.
Hold on. What part of the tranny did you masturbate to?
The whole thing.
The tits and the dick.
The whole
thing.
Balls. Here's something Bill Burr didn't know about me. And I'm bringing it up on the air.
Jesus Christ. Screeching halt, Joe.
You know how many trannies have sat in the studio?
Yeah, I know. But, dude, I never rubbed one out to one.
I know. I'm just saying, like, I'm not all alone in this. There's plenty of people that come through this studio every day that support the tranny.
Yes, they're called gay.
Norton's not gay. Norton loves trannies.
Norton doesn't count. Norton is, you know what it is about Jim? Jim is adorable. So no matter what Jim does, he is. I don't know what it is. He has done and talked about some of the most horrific stuff about it, but he always has, he's got that little Saint Nick. He's got that twinkle in his eyes. He does it. He's just, I don't know what it is.
Well, hey, I definitely
maybe
don't
you know
have
what it
twinkle.
Is. I think it was because he's been upfront about it from day one, and now this is like some dirt. I felt like I just walked in on you, and you just sort of whirled around, and there was some guy named
Fred. I
gotta
be honest, Bill.
Bo Peep.
I gotta be honest. I wasn't into it from day one. It's something that has progressed as I've slid down the slippery slope of porn on the internet. Wow. I stumbled into it one day, and I kind of liked it. And that's not all the time. It's just once in a while. You know?
See, Joe, that's why I told you, you got to stop watching that stuff on the internet, man. It messes with your mind. Look at the leaps and bounds you made. If there was no internet, okay? Mm-hmm. If there was no internet, back in the day, dude, in the 1800s, you're just out there farming all day. You're just psyched to go home and plow your wife in her big Laura Ingalls dress with the hoop skirt and all that type of stuff.
Maybe you are, maybe you're not.
Dude, there were no trannies in the 1800s. That's documented proof.
But I'm just saying.
Where did they hang out, Joe?
I know there were no trannies in the 1800s, but what I'm saying is maybe there were.
Of course there were. Half those guys who wrote that classical music.
No, that's not what a tranny is.
Dressed up like
a tranny
transvestite.
Isn't a guy that dresses as a woman. That's not what I'm talking about.
It's a chick
I'm talking
with a
about
dick.
The chicks with dicks. That's what I'm talking
it's
about.
It's basically a guy
that's
with
a hermaphrodite.
Implants. No, it's a guy
no,
with
it's
implants.
Not. It looks like a chick, except she's got a dick.
Oh,
she's
a transsexual.
Yeah, that's what
I was
I'm talking.
Thinking. Transvestite.
No. I'm talking no, like
you used the wrong slang. A tranny was always been.
I know,
been
right,
it's been a transvestite.
I don't know what
I'm
it
just
was.
An old guy. You know, when I was a kid, gay meant happy. Oh my God!
There's the picture.
And there's the visual. Oh my God, that's not real. That's not real. That's not real.
But that's also not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about a chick.
Dude, how can you just sit there so subtly? That was one of the greatest lines you've ever delivered. See, that's not what I'm talking about. Like, we just saw some Barbie doll with a Tommy Lee
like
apparatus.
Like, pull out a hot tranny with big tits and she's got a dick, though. That doesn't bother me. I kind of like it a little bit.
Jesus Christ, Joe.
I don't know. Maybe I got a little gay in me. I don't fucking know. What are you going to do?
Yeah, I think
after
I
all,
think
I did move into in the Hell's Kitchen. Yeah. Clinton Hill, as it's now called. The what do you got over there, Danny? You pulling something up?
I'm finding something.
This is the exact thing. Like, Aaron, I don't know about you, but when I go on the internet, like, I live in a very small corner. I go from MySpace to YouTube, Wikipedia, NFL, NBA, MLB.com, all that type of stuff. I did the YouPorn thing for a minute, and I don't know. I was funny. I was watching YouPorn with Joe going, dude, isn't this stuff great? It's all free. And Joe's like, yeah, this is kid stuff. This is the same guy. Danny, he watched Two Girls, One Cup, right? He watched Two Girls, One Cup.
There you go. It's a hot chick, but she's got a little dinger. She's got a little dinger between her stems.
Dude, it's fucking... Dude, that's disgusting. It's like, it doesn't even make sense.
That's kind of why I like it.
It's...
But what turns you on about it?
I mean, it's a chick with a cock swinging around. I don't know. It just gets me going a little bit.
The bottom half is a dude.
I got to be honest. I puffed up a little bit when he swung that monitor around.
Ugh.
I don't know. It's like a freakish mutiny fucking...
No, freakish mutiny is you got some sort of growth... You know what
it's
I mean?
Like, yeah, I was
you got extra fingers.
Yeah, it's like
that's a dick, Joe. Joe, that's a dick.
I always wanted to fuck that green chick that dances around for Jabba in Return of the Jedi with the fucking weird head and the alien skin. You know, it's the same thing. It's just
it isn't because she didn't have a green dick.
Maybe she
with
did.
Purple pubic hair.
Know. Who knows what she had down there? The world will never know.
We get the picture. Ugh.
Can I ask you a question? Is that photoshopped?
No.
That one's...
No, that's a TV right there.
She's all right. She's still got a little too much man in the face.
Dude, come on. Yeah, it looks like China. She was anorexic.
Too much man in the cock. What are you talking about?
Nah, it's got to look like a hot like chick that just happens to have a penis.
Looks like if Antonio Banderas had titties.
It's got to be a hot chick that just happens to have a penis.
But see,
dude, you know what? Can you commit to the fucking operation already? You know what I mean? Don't get like different parts. That's really, dude. That's really disgusting. How many people out there think Joe's guy got a little sugar in his tank?
Well, it's not disgusting.
866 Wow, one wow. We're gonna try to figure out. We're gonna get to the bottom of Joe. Joe, he likes mothers.
It's not disgusting, but if you say that's disgusting, you're saying homosexuality is disgusting completely. You know.
No, I'm not. No, I'm not, because I get that. I get it's a dude and who likes other dudes. I get that.
What freaks you out
For me,
I got you.
Yeah, what's freaking me out is it's the pizza with everything on it. You know what I mean? You just got... It's when you check every box down the what are you...
Yeah,
what,
cheese steak with pepperoni and extra cheese.
That is a human being with, like, all the options. Like, fully loaded. You got the AC, you got the cock, the balls, the tit.
I like it. It's
vagina.
The future. It's progress.
What do we got here? I'm trying to see. Nobody has called in yet to determine. Let's talk to Nick on line two.
It's being screened.
Oh, it's being screened. Okay.
Nick on line two is being screened.
I'm trying to find some. People are still trying to get you out of jury duty, Joe. I guess there's...
Aaron says seven.
Number seven. Okay, there's Fred in Hoboken. What's going on, man?
Hey, what's going on? You guys are talking about Two Girls, One Cup, right?
Absolutely.
Yep.
Yeah, they got a follow-up to that now. It's off the website. It's Two Girls, One Finger. It's these two Asian girls, and it might be worse than Two Girls, One Cup.
What do they do?
Well, like, they...
Oh, wait. Danny, pull it up on that fucking screen. Let's watch it on the air.
Yeah, you can see this. No. These girls vomit each other.
No, tell us. We're going to watch it. Don't
you
tell us.
Watch it? All right.
We're going to watch it, and call back, all right? Thank you.
All right, no problem. All right.
Jesus Christ.
Just hit two girls.
I can't. Okay, she's throwing up in the other one's mouth.
Ugh.
In the other one, ugh.
That's disgusting.
Okay, can we cross promote here the eggnog drinking contest coming up on Opie and Anthony?
That's disgusting.
Okay.
There we go. Oh, this is going to be bad, I can tell.
This is child's play. This is child's play.
Wait!
Oh, wait, now they're playing with it. They're playing with the puke.
Seriously, that makes me want to puke, dude. That's worse than two.
Well, watch it, then.
I'm watching it.
Tough it out, Joe. We just sat there looking at all your trannies. Oh, there's a... what is that? What do you call that? One...
There you go.
Oh, Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ. Turn that fucking thing off.
Wait. That's fake. That's fake.
Shit never looks real, but dude, it's just like...
That's a piece of rubber that...
They CGI it, right? Tell me. No, just like that fake wave...
That was a piece of rubber.
In Perfect Storm.
Look at it. Do your duty, soldier.
Turn your key. Yeah, I thought Two Girls, One Cup. I thought after a while, like, that was poo was starting to look like...
That was a fake fucking turd. That was a rubber... That was fake. You could see it was fake the way it was coming out of her.
Two Girls, One Cup, I actually heard it was a melted down trophy. It had that little bit of gold. You didn't hear about that? And then they put it in the freezer. Dude, look it up.
The facts are out there, man.
That is disgusting, man.
Where do you get this information from?
I
streaming everywhere. It's just being strange.
I don't know. I just sort of go with my gut.
That's from Heat. You never saw Heat?
What is Heat? The Al Pacino movie?
Yeah, that's the thing. Guys, never mind. Forget. I thought you would get the reference.
Joe, I don't watch movies the way you do because I have basic cable. And I have basic cable, and I have movie channels, so I'm able to watch other stuff. I've never watched so many movies in my life since I've stayed with you, where you don't have cable. I was literally it's so fucking horrific over there. He has me sitting there looking at VHS Tootsie, going like, it's kind of funny. maybe I'll pop that in.
Tootsie. Maybe I'll whack off to Tootsie later.
Joe, you're really...
I'm just joking, dude.
You're the guy, too, who always wants to go highbrow on this show. That's the funny thing is.
I'm just
and
joking.
You're letting out your inner...
I like a little tranny porn now and again. And I think, sexually, the farthest I could go is I could let a tranny blow me. What could you do sexually? That's how this started. What's the furthest you could take it?
Furthest I could go is...
Yeah, and really go somewhere.
Shut up. Tell me where I got to go with it.
No, I'm just saying...
You tell me I got to surpass what you did?
I'm just saying
I definitely should have opened.
Tell me your creepy secret that you want to fucking... You know what I mean? Like, tell me the creep... Because that was a big confession I just made.
Oh, do I have... I don't know that I have any left, Joe. I think this is the furthest I could go. I could have a dude who looked like a girl. You know those ones where you wouldn't even know, but they're fully clothed, unlike those fucking things. And they are things, dude, because there's no sex on that, all right?
I know.
I could get... And this is the thing. I know it's a dude, though. I have to know it's a dude.
Yeah, it can't be a trick. It can't be the old switcheroo.
I could let her take, like... If there was some sort of, like, tongs, you know, that you toss meat with, if you could put rubber gloves on the end of them, I could allow her to... Dude, it's just a line I don't want to cross. And I have no desire,
dude. It's saying, could you if you had to?
If I had to?
That's this game.
Well, put something on the table, Joe.
Could you take a straight...
Put something on the table. Put something on the table, Joe. Danny, could you please stop bringing those fucking pictures up? It's disgusting. It's disgusting. We're looking at...
Joe likes it, though.
I love it. I saw nothing hotter than a hot tranny banging a chick. It's like the fucking hottest thing ever.
No, dude. Like, I've done most of the shit that I've wanted to do. Like, I wanted to bang a fucking married broad. I did that.
Could you complete the hando from the hot guy dressed as a woman?
Could I what?
The man dressed as a woman. Could you complete the hand job?
Oh, I have to do it?
No, he does it for you. He's giving you a hand job. Could you complete it if you had to?
What do you mean? I could finish myself? You're saying
could you have an orgasm?
You're not speaking in the proper terms here.
Could you finish? Could you have an orgasm?
What is on the table? There's nothing on the table. Like,
You have to do it fucking reason.
If I don't do it, I'm not making it in stand-up comedy.
Yeah, there you go. You could fucking do it. I know you could.
Dude, you know what? I would.
Of course you would.
Just to do it. Yeah, but you know what? A light would go out in my eye. I would never be the same guy. I'd wear shades a lot.
If I had to, I could probably fuck a dude if it meant my career. If it was like, you have to do this right now.
But Joe, to be honest with you, what you've been talking about, it's not that big a leap. The only thing you're missing is the vagina.
No, it is, dude. Because they look like chicks. I'm attracted to chicks. I'm not attracted to men. You see what I'm saying?
I think Joe's going in wrong direction with Tranny. I think someone's going to give you some advice. Can we please talk to this guy, Scott, on line three? Line three. Scott, you want to give Joe some advice?
Yeah. Yeah, Joe.
Yes.
I did the Tranny thing one time. You can't. They got a smell to them and the whiskers and all that stuff still. What I think is really hot is just the hermaphrodites. You still got the pussy there, plus you got, you know, a little something extra.
Well, you know what's funny?
What, something to hang on to as you thrust your way in? Like is a whole joystick?
Is that what a doctor says to you if you have a hermaphrodite at the hospital? Look, yeah, you still got the pussy there. There's a little something extra.
Hey,
no, listen.
You're user-friendly.
Listen, that's why I said...
They got some really good-looking hermaphrodites on the net.
That's why I said that I couldn't fuck a tranny, because I was just like, there's something about probably when they get the pants off that you really see that it's a dude. You know what I mean?
Yeah, it's
well,
a dick,
maybe,
dude.
Maybe it's because it's such an oddity to have
it's the dick. I mean, what is
the... And the balls.
No. Not a lot of them pre-op trannies don't have balls.
But they still have a dick.
Yeah, they get their balls cut off.
They just have a dinghy?
If they get a lot of money, you know.
Well, let me ask you a question, sir. Let me ask you a question. Do you consider yourself straight and you have like a fetish? Are you sort of gay? Are you like. Because, I mean, there's a lot of gay guys out there would not mess with the hermaphrodite.
I think what it is now is in my 40s now and stuff. And I've been to the Philippines and done all kinds of crazy stuff over there. It's just one more thing to try.
And when you say all sort of crazy things, are we...
Philippines?
Yes.
Oh, man, they sit on your dick over there and do spins. They're crazy. It's great.
Okay, all
did
of age?
Wear, dude, did you wear rubbers when you were over there? Or did you fuck any of them raw?
I did. I barebacked a lot of them, yeah.
Holy Christ. And have you been tested? Are you clean?
Well, this was back in the 80s, man. It was before AIDS even first started.
Made the leap?
There.
God, the heyday.
Yeah.
God, the heyday. Can you imagine being around in the fucking 60s, 70s, the amount of fucking...
All you need. All right, man, thanks for coming.
Thanks, buddy.
All you need was penicillin.
Ugh.
Dude, you saw what happened, man. They were out there Woodstock butt naked fucking in the mud. That's where AIDS came from, was that mud up in Woodstock, dude. You can't have 600,000
yeah,
people naked.
Jerry Garcia pissing and
fucking in the mud,
puking
dude.
Into
exactly.
The mud, and then you fuck in it, and then AIDS comes out.
That's where it came from. I'll tell you, they're way off base going over to Africa, talking to fucking monkeys and shit. It's right there in the video. All right, listen, you listening to Uninformed? we're gonna take a break. We're going to do the final 40 minutes here. Keep it here. Thanks for listening.
It's Uninformed with Bill Burr and Joe DeRosa.
All right, we're back on Uninformed. I'm going to pick up that fear. That sounds like classic punk. That's one genre of music that I know nothing about. Like when people talk about the Dead Kennedys.
They're awesome, man. Dead Kennedys are awesome. We should do Dead Kennedys next show.
I listened to it one time. It was kind of goofy shit. Singing in a weird high voice. Okay.
The guy's got a weird voice, but they're great. That is a slow fade, boy.
No. It's not on him. It's not on him, because that time we were actually talking about the music. So
I know. I'm just joking.
He left it in.
I'm just joking over there.
But, yeah, I don't know anything about... punk music. My brother used to listen to this Racer X album, and I actually started listening to it. It was great, but I was such a hack music guy. Like, I just listened, like, I was totally, like, Tom Petty. AC/DC was about as hardcore as I got, but I never, like, all those underground bands, man, I never got into it.
You gotta, the Dead Kennedys are great, but, like, they have... JL Biafra is a great front man, but his voice is an acquired taste, because he's like...
It's all like it sounds like he's mocking singing. And I'm sitting there, how is he get a name like the Dead Kennedys, and this is not interesting to me?
But they're awesome. Great lyrics. Really, like, back when punk was like punk and it still had something to say or whatever. It was
and
good.
A mohawk was a mohawk, right, Joe?
Yeah, a leather jacket was a leather jacket.
When you put a safety pin in your ear, it meant something.
You had like your girls punks. In your songs.
Dude, speaking of that, I was telling you guys early, I saw Van Halen with David Lee Roth out there at the Staples Center.
So fucking jealous. I wanted to see that so bad.
They were awesome.
Of course they were.
They were awesome. They started off, they played You Really Got Me. Started off, da-da-da-da-da-da-da, and the curtain comes down. They're just jamming, and David Lee was on this ramp behind the drum set, just waving this flag for no apparent reason, but it totally made sense because it's him. You know what I mean? This guy has walked around with assless spandex. So, I mean, the flag, it was the shit. He sounded great. The band was unbelievable. I just looking at the guy, it was just, you know, that guy, arguably one of the greatest frontmen of all time.
He's not my favorite, but he's one of... Do you got any Van Halen, Danny? Play a Van Halen snippet, just so we can get a little...
Dude, what you need is his live shit, that stuff he does in between. He's just... He's... The guy, he was insane. He walks around. He always does that big, goofy smile when he's on TV. It doesn't work, but it's because he's used to playing arenas. He's like a wrestler.
That's hilarious. It's like when
he's got to have the back row has to see how much of a good time.
It's like when,
this is what you play. We asked for Van Halen, and you get the keyboard
Hot for Teacher
that broke him up to begin with.
There you go.
There we go.
Yeah, I swear to God, Joe, if I played this during the drum battle, it would have been over. This is what Danny was going to play if we brought the double pedal.
He's used to playing to stadium. It's like when Al Jolson made the jump over to talkies from theater. He made the jump to, and he's on the screen making that fucking smell. They go, hey, we had to tone it down a little bit. You're not in a fucking theater right now.
All right. So you're talking about David Lee Roth, and you have one of the longest intros.
And it just, it was like, there was no Eddie Van Halen in it.
Skip up to the, I don't feel tardy. Skip up to that part. So we're going to hear what a great... Skip up to when it kicks in after that first dropout.
Just pick another song. Just anything off of Van Halen 1. That's basically what they played. They played like all... The whole first side of Van Halen 1, then like Atomic Punk, Jamie's Crying, Ice Cream Man. It was the shit.
They did but 19...
Oh, yeah. And,
that's
and,
a fucking awesome
and
song.
And he told this big, long story about being with some chick out in front of the car and all, you know, with the car and all the stuff he did.
Nice.
And then he just ends, and she'd always look at me after I did that and said, Dave... play the ice cream song. And then he just starts playing it and the fucking place just goes bananas. And I was just looking at the guy going like, lead singers don't know how to do that anymore. Or am I just being like, maybe they are out there. I'm
dude,
just too
there's
old
a
guy.
Level of showmanship. It's like going to see Don Rickles. You know what I mean? It's just there's a level of showmanship to it that you don't see anymore. That's all.
Yeah. Oh yeah, you're big Rat Pack.
Yeah, I am. But so we were having a discussion the other day of
Who the best frontman is.
So David Lee Roth, play us some... Now, this is my vote for best frontman ever. Freddie Mercury gets my vote. Play a Queen snippet. Or
Jesus
play
Christ.
That. All right, well, play that part of fucking... Play
Joe,
that again.
Joe,
play
this
that.
Is why we don't do prepared pieces. Because
play
whenever
that part
we
of
do,
Hot for Teacher again
this,
that you were
this is
playing.
What happens.
So we can hear David Lee. Hold on. Right here, it says it all. That's a fucking Sprite commercial. You know, you know how many products they sold with that? Oh, yeah! In the 80s. All right, play the Queen snippet now. Freddie Mercury, King.
Dude, you know what? You know why Joe likes Freddie Mercury? Because he probably had the tranny thing, too.
Yeah.
The two you could hang out. You know, he could sing some songs
together.
I should
play that piano in Bohemian Rhapsody.
What do you think, man? You're part of the Aerosmith lineage here. Aaron, who do you think your best frontman of all time?
David Lee Roth, Freddie Mercury. I mean, they're both amazing. You
know, this is my favorite Queen song ever, the song. Just let this guy, Freddie Mercury's voice is like unstoppable when it kicks in here.
Probably wearing a diaper on stage with that little half a mic stand.
Yeah. He sounds fucking, he's just great, dude.
He's got the shit.
Attitude, yeah. He was banging everything.
But I mean, like,
he really was.
Man,
too.
Woman, he didn't give a fuck.
But then he got like Mick in his heyday. You know,
Mick Jagger?
Mick Jagger in his heyday was great. You know, I mean, like, you know, Steven's great, but I don't think he's a great frontman. You know, he doesn't really, if you go to shows and you watch, he doesn't address the crowd too much. He's like, hello, Cleveland, and he kind of starts playing, but he doesn't really sit there like, oh, yeah, I remember, you know, we all sat down, we wrote this song in 1972, and he doesn't really,
yeah, but you know something?
He doesn't address the
crowd. I don't
crowd.
Like that Bruce Springsteen two-hour story.
Yeah, but there's
a happy
like,
medium?
Yeah, there's a happy medium. Either,
dude, you know, you know,
he,
you
he
know,
doesn't do any.
You know who got trashed the most, like when I was a kid and everybody was coming up in the 80s, the one person people used to freak out about See, Joe, right there, you probably thought you moved your head away from the mic.
No, I realized that you just
went,
I'm sorry. I know. I'm sorry.
I thought they were still playing Hot for the Teacher. Hot for the Teacher.
Is that
crazy
song, is that Hot for the Teacher song?
No. So anyways, the guy that people used to always trash and just said sucked was... Rick Ocasek, or Rick, the guy from the Cars.
He was awesome.
Dude, I know so many guys who went to go see him, said he came out, and all he said was, good evening, and then he just would sing the songs, and then would just say good night. And I know a guy who went to the show, and after the dude said good night, he said, I was standing there like, you know, what the fuck, and there was somebody like three rows behind just going, rip off! Rip off! It's like, what did you honestly want that guy to do? He was in his videos. He was a stiff. He was just sitting there. Now, he was a guy, you know, I always thought was going to die. I mean, he just looked like
he was dying.
He was on his deathbed.
He looked like he was dying. You know,
who's the worst guy you ever saw?
Like
the worst concert you went to? I'll give you mine. John Cougar Mellencamp.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
Dude, it was one of those concerts, right, where... I didn't, somebody I knew had tickets and I had nothing to do. Come on, not really. Come on, dude. And he came out. Oh, he was just, it was
awful.
Dude,
I can't.
Spit it out, Joe.
I think every concert I've ever gone to was a band I really wanted to see. So it's like, it's
dude,
very,
you never got dragged to one or like, there's some girl, you want to fuck her.
You know the one I got dragged to? Phil Collins, when I was in high school, and he was awesome. He kicked ass. The whole first set was about homeless people and shit like that. Ugh. And then second set, they took a break. He came right out with Billy Don't Lose My Number and Easy Lover, and I was fucking hooked. I was like, this guy's delivered.
Do you know what's amazing about that guy? He's one of those guys. You know those guys who've just been going bald for 40 years and they just never quite go bald? Like,
yeah.
He's been hanging onto that landing strip.
He's got that widow's peak.
Yeah, since like, what was it, Live Aid? Dude, he's a hell of a drummer, but I'm telling you, dude, I never recovered after Sussudio.
I saw shows that I didn't like Pavement. I'm a big fan of Pavement.
Wait, you saw Phil Collins? Did he do his Can't Hurry Love and his little stupid dance?
I don't remember, to be honest with you. I just remember he did...
I think you're conveniently forgetting.
He did Billy Don't... Well, first of all, he started the show out. The stage was dressed like an alleyway. It looked like an alleyway. And there was this pile of trash cans at the front of the stage. And this homeless man walks out and sits at the trash cans. And hidden in the...
Underpaid actor. Okay.
Hidden in the trash cans was a drum set. And the homeless guy was Phil Collins. And he played a fucking drum solo. Like, right there. That's awesome, dude. You can't...
That's clever.
It was fucking awesome.
That's definitely cool. But that whole thing fucking annoys me where it's like, you know, here's a guy who flies around the world in private jets. How many homeless guys does he really even run into?
Yeah, I know. It's irritating.
I got to look at him every fucking day.
I know.
So,
that's irritating.
And this is the thing. When you interact with the homeless, yeah, you know, there's a 40% fucking hatred towards
him. That's
true. It's kind of like living with him. You still love your brother, but if you live with him, you know, part of you hates him.
Phil Collins never gave the homeless cranberry sauce with Kathleen Madigan.
Oh, at the Laugh Factory. It was mashed potatoes and it was Alonzo Bowden. Alonzo Bowden is a very giving individual.
Over there at the Laugh Factory.
He was serving it up.
Let's talk about... now, here's the thing we were talking about, too, with the front men.
Wait a minute. Aaron, I'm just going to get to the worst thing. What's the worst one you've seen? All those years being on the road with Aerosmith without getting you in trouble.
It was En Vogue, Vanilla Ice, and MC Hammer on one show.
Oh, Christ.
Jesus Christ.
That was the worst one. Why would you do that?
She's like, can you get me tickets? I'm like,
So you got tickets?
I got you tickets at the Worcester Centrum.
And then you went there?
Yes.
And you were the only guy with that. Remember the shoes that were in style back then? You had, was this the 80s or was this the early 90s where they would wear the shiny dress shoes with that little steel toe engraved thing in the end, those Bobby Brown shoes?
Yeah, there was everybody like that. But I just did it, you know, for the same reason everybody goes to a shitty concert like that, to get laid.
Here's,
you know, I mean, I even saw...
it's actually a legendary show in some weird way, you know?
You know, I saw Poison, you know, most all those 80s hair bands, you know, usually because...
Did you ever see Loudness?
No, I never saw.
I saw
heavy metal,
Bush.
That Asian band, they opened for everybody.
I saw Bush once, but at the time I liked it. I didn't feel... You know what? One concert, this is a funny story, that I did. At the time, I felt I was really pissed and I felt that I was ripped off, but now I really appreciate it. I went to see this band, Mr. Bungle, who is still one of my favorite bands, and their first album was very poppy and catchy and rock or whatever. And then their second album was really weird, very well-written music, but it was very avant-garde and like weird jazz shit and everything. And I went to their concert for their second album tour, and they were all wearing these fucking hoods and these leather masks and shit. And they wouldn't talk to the... They didn't address the crowd at all for the whole concert. And they played all shit from that second album. It was all creepy and weird and, like, boring. And everybody was pissed, including me, that they didn't play anything off the first album. And then they ended the set with a cover of Working for the Weekend by Loverboy.
That's actually funny.
It's hilarious, but at the time I was like 18 and I didn't get it, and I was like, what the fuck?
Oh, wait.
But now it's like, to me, I'm like, that's such a fucking funny...
We got a lot of people calling in saying who's the best and who's the worst.
No, this summer, I just saw the fucking parrot head guy.
Jimmy Buffett?
Jimmy Buffett. Top-notch worst.
Oh, definitely. He didn't even try?
No, he did five covers. He opened with a cover. During his encore, he had like three songs.
He did Beach Boy songs.
Yeah, it was like Beach Boy songs, a Dead song, a Bob Marley song.
Dude, anybody who dresses like Robin Williams.
Kenny Rogers songs.
Yeah, doesn't he cover Redemption song
or
something?
Yeah, he basically sounded like a bar cover band. You know, I mean, it's like almost a parody of himself.
So what do you guys want to hear? You want to hear best or worst?
Let's go best first and then go... Oh, no, do worst. We're talking about worst.
Let me see John, Nebraska, line one. John, what's up, man? Who's the worst you saw?
This was for pussy, and I went to Pat Benatar. They gave up the pussy, and I had to leave.
Oh, man. It was that bad? Pat Benatar, she had a good voice. Like,
you didn't get excited when she ripped out Heartbreaker? That's a good tune, you know, man.
I was a Chrissie Hynde fan, and I was strictly there for the pussy. I had to give it up.
Hell is for Children? That didn't get you going? Make you a little stiff there?
No. It was the most disgusting concert I've ever been to in my life.
All right. Sorry to hear that. All right. We got some more here. Let me get number four, then. You don't hear this one much. Sean in Texas, what's the worst one you saw?
Well, I went and saw Red Hot Chili Peppers and the Foo Fighters about 3 or 4 years ago.
How did that suck?
The Foo Fighters opened up for the Red Hot Chili Peppers.
Okay.
And I wasn't there for the Foo Fighters. I was there for the Red Hot Chili Peppers. Well, Foo Fighters came out and blew me away. I mean, Dave Grohl, he could put on a show. And he came out of the audience. He really entertained us. Red Hot Chili Peppers came out, and I thought, okay, this is going to be awesome. And they came out and played their set and left. And I was just so disappointed.
Oh, so that's more of a situation where they didn't necessarily suck. They just didn't follow the opening act?
Yeah, I mean, they just didn't do anything. They didn't interact. They didn't talk to the crowd. They didn't, you know, tell any stories like y'all were saying.
Oh, that blows. That does blow when they don't do that, because it seems like they are phoning it in.
I don't like that either. That's apparently happening right now with them.
It was like, we see them on TV and they really do good. So if there's no camera on them and they know there's no camera, they don't do anything.
Damn, he's just one show and that's it for the Chili Peppers with this guy.
Yeah,
all right, Sean, thanks for calling, man. Thank you.
I always thought the Chili Peppers are kind of self-righteous and holier than thou with their approach to everything. They always sort of have that... I'm not surprised.
Let's do
that
drugs
story.
And fuck each other.
I like when they kind of kept the rap kind of hip hop kind of punky thing going, but once they tried to start singing and making songs, you know,
well,
being
but there
too
was
poppy.
Like there was like a two album stretch where it was great.
He's got a great voice. I don't ever wanna feel.
Yeah, that's every chill. That's the problem now. Every single, it's like the verse. He's like, you're like, whatever.
I like him.
Let's do a couple other greatest frontmen. Of course, we got it to AC/DC, right?
Oh Jesus, Brian Johnson, Bon Scott. They're both great.
Play a clip of. I got to go Johnson over Scott though, just for the amount of effort.
Oh, that's a huge debate.
The effort the guy puts into it. We're watching those clips today.
What do you got here? I don't know.
What do we got? We got an AC.
Please tell me it's stiff upper lip. It's got to be stiff upper lip.
I think it's Back in Black.
Jesus Christ, he's got nothing. He's just got.
You've got nothing.
How about play it,
Pat?
How about we. Pointed to you and you're on.
Danny, can you pull stiff upper lip up over here?
No, because the fucking studio doesn't work.
He said no, because the studio doesn't work. There we go.
Let it go to the chorus. We got to hear what he goes. Keep it going.
I think stiff upper lip, man.
I want to hear him go.
I don't know that. Yes. Well, there's some obvious one. New Kids on the Block was the worst.
That's Joey McIntyre from Boston.
I know, right? Got kicked out of a Rod Stewart concert. That person just hung up for some reason.
Dude, I never noticed how much Axl Rose sounded like Brian Johnson. I never realized that.
Well, here's someone right here saying that he's the best. Put it on line number two. Hey, Jerry, what's up, man? Who do you vote for the best?
Axl Rose, hands down.
No
most
fucking
entertaining
way.
I have ever seen.
All right, well, Joe's trying to say Brian Johnson.
Yeah, but dude, you gotta go with consistency too, dude.
He never stopped.
How about some
never
longevity?
What about all the shows? Axl Rose has never sucked.
He said he never stopped. Let him finish.
When he's on stage, he's constantly moving, he's entertaining, he's energetic, he's getting the crowd pumped every time I've ever seen him.
Okay, how many times have you seen him?
About 6 or 7 times.
Because I know people that have seen them plenty of times, including myself, where he can't hit the notes. He's out of breath.
Yeah, but this is pre or after.
Does that count? Can you
Chinese democracy? You're talking
going,
about.
We're going all time, dude.
This is back in the day. Now that's
you got to still deliver the goods. You can't not show up at the concert because you're watching the Knicks game in your hotel room, and then there's a riot at the Spectrum in Philly. Do you know what I mean? That's not fair.
Oh, all right, Jerry. Thank you for calling. Well, you're saying like that, like longevity and stuff.
Dude, Brian Johnson. We watched that clip of Brian Johnson there on YouTube from the House of Blues. The guy's how old is he? 60. He's still wearing that little fucking Andy Cap hat. fucking churning out those notes, man.
I don't know. I was always a Bon Scott fan. I love Brian Johnson, but like...
I love Bon Scott. I'm not trashing Bon Scott.
I was always a slight nod, though. It used to be without a doubt I was a Bon Scott guy, but somewhere... Once Stiff Upper Lip came out, and... That was it for me. He did it again, and I was
mean,
just
like,
I mean,
you got
like,
Back in Black, one of the greatest rock albums ever.
Yeah,
you know, they've so, never I mean, matched you, that
always,
guitar
you always
sound
have
either.
That, you know, oh, Bon Scott, Brian Johnson. But Back in Black is probably one of the nastiest, like, rock albums ever. I mean, that thing is
no
bad.
Ballad. That's the only thing you got to give up ACD, just no ballad.
I mean, the closest thing to a ballad is Hell's Bells.
No ballad.
Slowish.
The guy dies. Bon Scott dies. The next album, they could have went all sappy. The next album's called Back in Black, Forget the Hearse, because I'll Never Die. It's just a whole tribute to Bon Scott, and then they do a fucking song called "Have a Drink on Me."
Yeah. No, and that was
after the
one
guy
song
drank himself to death.
That was the one song, I guess, that they dedicated to him. Was "Have
That's
a Drink on Me"?
Awesome.
Now, if it was the Chili Peppers, they would have wrote an anti-drinking song.
Yeah,
AC/DC just
something about
chose,
under a bridge or some shit.
Yeah, something. I don't ever want to drink. They were just AC/DC just plows right through it.
Have a drink, oh man.
They had the best. Brian Johnson had the best crowd, like crowd, whatever, on that live CD. You know, the DVD I have, whatever. Before they do "Whole Lotta Rosie," he just goes. The song they play before it just ends, and he takes a breath and he goes, "Here's a song about a dirty woman. It's called Whole Lotta Rosie." So it's like, that's the greatest fucking intro. Like, it just bare bones right down to it. He's
right,
awesome.
We got to take another break. Dude, when we come back, man, I want to talk about some of these holiday ripoffs already, because we already started shopping and that type of stuff. So you guys listen on Uninformed, man. Thanks for listening. Keep it here. We got another 15.
Uninformed with Bill Burr and Joe DeRosa.
All right, man.
Yeah.
Bill Burr, Joe DeRosa, hanging out here. We're on the final 5 minutes of another Uninformed. Aaron, thank you for coming down.
Thanks for having me, guys.
Thanks, man.
Thanks. No, I
as always,
it.
I guess we're in the final few minutes here, other than whoring ourselves out. We'll wait till the music starts, and we'll start hyping our gigs.
What did you
want up?
Oh, sorry, go ahead.
I just want to talk about something like, you know, I decided, you know what, I'm gonna start my Christmas shopping, you know, like every other tool out there, the week of, you know, the Thanksgiving holiday. And, dude, I've caught a couple of ripoffs out there. Dude, you know they remastered the Led Zeppelin. Jimmy Page remastered those same
again?
7, 8. I mean, this is the third time, I think, since the 90s And they always say that they're gonna, they, you know, they're gonna remaster them. Aaron, you're in the music business. What the fuck am I listening for? I listen to it. It's all they do is they just have a couple extra more intro seconds where they have the guy. All of a sudden, you can hear John Bonham going, a one and a two and a, and you never were able to hear that. And then it just goes right into the song again. It's the same shit.
Well, the bullshit answer is that it's the technology changes, and with the technology changes, you know, you get better clarity. But the main thing is just money. I mean, repackage, refiltered, regurgitation. I mean, it's just repackage it and sell it. You know, I mean, dude, that's basically what it is.
You know, they got this Miles Davis thing coming out, okay? Like, there's a guy, like, he's one of the, you know, he's a jazz guy, so every song he had is, like, 58 minutes long. So he has all these countless CDs. He had this thing, On the Corner was the name of the album.
Yeah.
He was trying to do, like, what Herbie Hancock was doing, Headhunters, and they didn't really get it or whatever. But the CD itself is decent, but they came out with this box set of just outtakes from one album that they put out there. It's like seven CDs of shit Miles Davis said, nah, that's not good enough to put on the CD. Now, like, some moron is going to go down there.
Dude, it's incredible.
And I don't understand, like, how you could be into an artist that much. That would be like you know, the intro to this show where Steve's going, like, you're listening to Uninformed with Bill Burr and Joe DeRosa. No, I didn't like that take. Let me listen to, you're listening to Uninformed with Bill Burr and Joe. I mean, you can listen to fucking five CDs of that?
Yeah, it's ridiculous. It's the same shit they do on the DVDs where it's like 17 deleted scenes, and it's literally like
never released song that they all thought sucked.
Lord of the Rings. There's probably about 17 different, like, DVD versions. It's the extended director's cut. You know, I mean, exactly.
That was one of the most self-indulgent movie experiences I've ever seen in my fucking life.
Hey, here's a guy completely off topic. Said in 83 Van Halen sucked. They must have been hammered. Can I please take this call?
Yeah, go ahead.
I got to hear this guy here. Line six. Hey, Jeff, what's up, man? What's the worst show you saw?
Hello?
Hello?
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you, man. What's up?
Hey, man, I saw Van Halen at the US Festival in the summer of 83, and they sucked.
What?
I mean, I saw Ozzy that day, I saw the Scorpions, and they kicked ass, and the Van Halen came out, David Lee Roth couldn't even remember the fucking words. He even said, I don't remember the fucking words. It was fucking embarrassing, man. You just kicked him to fuck him in the crowd, and it was ridiculous.
Dude, you sound like you're still drunk from that show.
No, man. I'm just a truck driver.
Oh, all right. Well, thanks for calling in, man.
I saw Sinatra. He couldn't remember the words.
He couldn't remember the words?
No, I saw him right at the end. I saw him his last fucking run at Radio City Music Hall.
Dude, there's one thing to be in the prime of your career and you're completely hammered and you're pissing it down the toilet. And there's another thing, that, you know, you got Alzheimer's and you're still putting a tux on. Your hands are shaking as you're trying to get that cummerbund around you.
But when he nailed it, he nailed it. It was worth, you know, it was worth seeing because I can say, hey, I saw Sinatra, you know.
We got to talk about that next time we do this show, Joe, because I got to be honest with you. I've gotten a lot of those Rat Pack CDs.
Yeah, I know.
And Sinatra, dude, like, Sammy Davis Jr. is without a doubt the best entertainer out of all of them, but his tunes stink. The only songs that hold up are Sinatra. Dean Martin. Everybody goes off on Dean, but that, oh, my God, he's just...
You got to hear the right shit with those guys. He's awesome.
Thanks.
All right. Well, let's save that argument for later.
Yeah, next
when
show.
When we walk out of the room.
Next time we come out.
When we leave the studio.
Hey, we got to hype some gigs coming up. Me and Joe DeRosa are going to be down at Caroline's Comedy Caroline's Comedy Club, December, like, 6th through the 11th.
I think it's 5th to the 11th.
5th to the 11th.
5th or 6th to the 11th,
I'm informed about our own dates. And the week after that, I'm going to be at Hilarities in Cleveland. And then for New Year's, I'm going to be at the Improv in Fort Lauderdale. Go to myspace.com/BillBurr or BillBurr.com, B-U-R-R. Please come out to the show.
And I'll be at Caroline's with Burr. And the week after that, I'll be headlining Joey's in Detroit.
Joey's.
Joey's.
That's a good time.
This weekend, I'll be at Gotham Comedy Club with Colin Quinn, though. So come out, myspace.com/JoeDeRosa.
Are you
going to
sign the wall out there at Joey's? Joey's.
I've never been there. Do you sign the wall?
Oh, yeah. You know what, dude? I never sign the wall. I think I signed the wall out there, but I never write the year.
Do you want to plug the...
Yeah, oh, you got anything coming up? Oh, Aaron, we're acting like he's not even here.
Yeah, I guess check out Joe Perry's RockYourWorld.com for hot sauce and upcoming food products for my stepfather.
Mac and cheese and all that stuff.
Mac and cheese and all that kind of
cheese.
Stuff.
The Aerosmith grocery list there.
Ugh, I can't believe I just did that.
Dude, I literally... What you do? Dude, you got to do it. It's a business. Look at me whoring myself out.
Yeah.
If I had any sort of integrity, dude, I would have a line of like koozies with my stupid head on it. I just never think to do stuff like that. So anyways, Joe, I'll be back here in a week, man. I'll see you at Caroline's. Everybody, thanks for listening to another Uninformed. We will be back again in January. That's it. Have a nice Christmas shopping thingamajig.
Saturday Night Virus.